in the name of Jesus, drought in your life, that even when it is physical rainy season, it is still dry season spiritually, financially, and otherwise. I decree and declare, let the rain begin to fall. Let the rain begin to fall. Let the rain begin to fall.
You're welcome to another spirit-filled message on Christocentric Message. If you're new to this channel, I would entreat you to hit on that subscribe button and then to like this video. As well, I would want you to share this message across, because we believe that as this message is coming forth, it's going to bless you. Your graces are going to be imparted unto you, and then God is going to visit your home. Thank you for watching. Stay blessed.
I'm excited every time I have the opportunity to come before us and teach, because I have learned through experience that one of the ways to bless people is to enlighten them. Hallelujah. You can give people money, you can give people privileges, but one of the ways you bless people is to enlighten them. Unfortunately, we live in a generation that frowns at enlightenment, because enlightenment is intangible, and we have been trained by our environments to be carnal. We always want something we can hold and relate with here and now, such as money, clothes, cars, and all of these very, very mundane things. But the informations that are intangible, that empower us, usually we do not have the patience to submit. I was having a conversation with one of the protocol people while I was on my way coming, and I was driving and I looked at him. He was sitting at the other side, and I was wondering why I was looking at him while I was driving at the same time. And I told him, I said, look, my friend, you will never succeed in life if you are not mentored and trained. And he looked at me. I said, listen carefully to what I'm about to teach when we come. And I was giving him instances. I have learned, and I am more convinced than ever before, that training and mentorship is how successful people are made. It's not one of the ways, it's the only way. There are no options. Any other person giving you an option is a sign that he doesn't know what he's saying. Their mentorship and training is the only way people can become sustainably successful. Truthfully speaking, mentorship is not listening to a man speak to you. Listen carefully. That's attendance. Mentorship is not opening up your ears to a man's teachings and having the teachings in your archives, your laptops, your systems. It may be a pathway, but mentorship starts with a decision that I am willing to submit myself to be taught, and I will insist till I understand. Praise God. Mentorship does not start with the availability of information. It starts with a determination from the heart of the one who will be the recipient. It's a manifestation of humility to admit that there are dimensions that we do not yet see and know and have. Regardless of what our achievements are, when we come before God and we come before people He has anointed to teach, to train, to build, it is important that you assume the position of a student immediately and listen carefully. And not just take notes, but write it in the tablets of your heart. And then obtain grace. That's why we pray after every message. Why? We're obtaining grace to walk in the reality of what we have heard. The Bible says, now that ye know these things, happy are you if you do them. It's one thing to know, but it's another thing to have the grace to do. Brothers and sisters, listen. I may not boast. It will be arrogant to boast of knowing everything. Nobody knows everything. It will be arrogant to make a boast to claim to have arrived. But one thing I can tell you is, if you submit yourselves to these teachings wholeheartedly under God, you will never fail.
regardless. It's not a prayer. It's the resultant effect. Trust me on this. The ideas that we communicate to you in this house are not necessarily my ideas alone. They have been age-long ideas that have been used by men and women who changed the course of history. They have been age-long ideas that our fathers have used to do mighty things for God. And now God has granted us the privilege to access these ideas. So I don't want you, whilst you are listening to these things, to have a cynical heart debating whether or not you think is worthy of acceptance. Personally, I've made a commitment to believe and work with them. So whether or not you do not believe it, it does not affect my outcome. Because you see, success is not corporate. Everybody will have to obey himself into the promised land. I can help you, but I can't force you there. I came tonight with a very strong burden, and I was very excited when the Lord put this in my heart. It had been something that I had planned to share, but it was so powerful when the Lord put it in my heart. I really want you to succeed. God sees my heart, and the leaders know how much we are passionately committed about the success of everyone. I believe and have held this conviction for years. And I have taught many, including our students in the School of Ministry, that loyalty is a debt that you must pay. When people are loyal to you, it's as though you owe them something. When people are loyal to your anointing, loyal to your words, loyal to your grace, loyal to the dealings of God upon your life, you must reciprocate that loyalty by ensuring that their trust is not disappointed. That's why we pray. That's why we fast. That's why we prepare. That's why we research. That's why we study, to make sure that every information that you receive is not only spiritual, but life applicable and indomitable, having a character that can suppress whatever limitations. Hallelujah. So pray one more time and say, Lord, I submit myself afresh. Please pray from your heart. Affect my life, breathe on me. I look to you for life. Affect my life, breathe on me. I look to you for life. Affect my life, breathe on me. I look to you for life. Affect my life, breathe on me. I look to you for life. Affect my life, breathe on me. I look to you for life. Affect my life, breathe on me.
I look to you for life.
Hallelujah. Success system. Part 1. Success systems. Part 1. Success systems. Part 1. The goal of this series is twofold. Number one, to reveal to us the requirements that must be satisfied for you to experience lasting kingdom success. Number two, to unveil to you the laws, the principles, the secrets, the mysteries that are responsible for commanding success from God's standpoint. It's an attempt to help our lives bear fruit. It's an attempt to make and help contribute to making our lives meaningful. It's an attempt to improving the quality of our lives and to help us in our quest to become effective spiritual people, effective kingdom ambassadors. It's an attempt to create balance to every area of our lives so that we are not unfruitful in any aspect. So this is a very powerful series. We're starting off with part one. And I pray that God will help us.
two scriptures very quickly, and then we'll take the course content. Second Peter chapter 1 verse 8. Please, media, you need to work with us very, very fast tonight. Media, help us. Second Peter 1 verse 8. And then we'll look at Genesis 39 verse 2 to 6. It says, "For if these things be in you," what things? Certain informations, certain traits. "For if these things be in you and abound, are lavish," it says, "they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful." In this context, it says, in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, but it applies to every area of life. If these things abound in you and they are lavish, they will produce an effect. The effect is that they can stop barrenness and unfruitfulness from your life. It didn't say if these things be around you. If these things be in you, if you believe them, imbibe them, then it says you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful. Genesis 39, 4 verses 2 to 6. Genesis 39. "And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian." We're reading to verse 6. "And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord did what? Made all that he did to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found favor or grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him overseer over his house and all that he had put in his hands." Verse 5. "And it came to pass from that time that he had made him overseer in his house and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field." The last verse. "And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand." Everybody say trust. "And he knew not aught, and he knew not aught he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well favored." Help us tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. Write down the things we are going to be considering in this series. Please write. Those online, follow us, or at least you'll be patient to allow the media lead you. There are a few things that we are going to be looking at, and wherever we can stop tonight, we'll stop and pray. But please, I want to take my time and teach you this. I want you to understand it, and I trust that God will take advantage of this series to bless and lift us in Jesus' name. The first thing we'll be considering tonight is the reality of failure. How real is failure? Is it a mirage or is it real? Number two, we're going to look at the concept of success in the kingdom. Number two, we're going to look at the concept of success in the kingdom. What is God's idea of a successful person? The concept of success in the kingdom. Number three, we're going to look at the concept of laws and principles. The concept of laws and principles. Can I continue? Number four, definition of terminologies. There's too much confusion, so we need to clarify terminologies as it regards or as it relates to kingdom success. Definition of terminologies. And then number five, the laws of success. The laws of success. We're going to be examining the laws. And then number six, we'll end with a very strong impartation and trust God to carry something that will activate these dimensions in our lives. Praise the Lord. If you believe it, say amen. Amen. Now, statistically speaking, five out of every 100 people ever become successful in their lifetime. 5% out of every 100 people that you see, only about 5% of them ever become successful. Whether from a human standpoint, in fact, when you say from a divine standpoint, the statistic reduces again. Very few people. A young man gets up living his life bubbling with joy, hoping he will be successful. And you see the excitement of life on his face. But that same young man, give him 70, 80 years down the line, is a testimony of pain, a testimony of regrets, a testimony of sadness, lost opportunities, mishandled loss, a life of fatal failure. Most people die in pain. Most people die advising their children, don't be like me. Most people die apologizing to their generation because they finally are forced to swallow the bitter pill and admit they did not make it. Pastors, business people, parents, young people, the same challenge is eating up our society. The correct definition of success and a life that will become a template and a model enough, worthy of emulation, as far as kingdom success is concerned. So it's a big issue. It's a tragedy that about 5%, can you imagine that? Out of every 100 people, whether they are churchgoers, fasting giants, prayer warriors, 5% of them eventually will become successful, whether in ministry, whether in business. In fact, it is said that over 70 to 80% of churches that start up end by the end of that year. They can't continue. No members, no resources, no wisdom, spiritual forces that they've not been able to surmount, and other auxiliary factors that add to enforce the failures of people. Write this down. Failure is real. Failure is real. Second point, failure will happen to you if you allow it. I think it's a revelation many of us need to come to terms with. We have this inheritance mindset that by default, just because you have a nice name or you think you are too kind to fail, there's no such reality in the school of success. Let me tell you, everybody is a potential candidate for failure until you exempt yourself. It's a reality that is upon us by default. A lot of spiritual people will say, I reject it. You better listen quietly to what I'm saying. I am a very spiritual person. I have learned the foolishness of exaggerating truth beyond the jurisdiction of their relevance is what causes failure as a side effect. Please listen carefully. I love you too much to deceive you. I love you too much to mislead you. And one of the graces God has given us in this ministry is capacity for balance. So anything you hear that you do not understand, just be patient. By God's grace, I'm a good builder. Every house is built by some man, he says, but God is the builder of all. And so we will not build a house that is lopsided. We'll build a house that stands solid on the rock. No matter what shakes it, it remains there. Say amen. Failure is real, brothers and sisters. There are pastors who are failures, regardless of their spirituality. There are churches that are failing and have failed. Some of us here seated right now, it's an uncomfortable truth, but right now, if you will admit, you know you are failing. Woefully for many of us. Are we together now? Yes. Disappointed expectations. And it's important that we find out God's system to bail ourselves out and do so very, very fast. So failure is real. Failure is very real. We see it every day. You see failure in the face of angry people who walk upon our streets. You see failure in the face of failed marriages. A man and a woman who love themselves
and have an agreement to live happily. And right now you see someone age 24 and he tells you, I have divorced. How long did you marry? 6 months? 1 year? How about failed businesses? How about failed career pathways? How about failed ministries? How about disappointed expectations? I should enter a particular dimension of the anointing by now. And after donkey years, you are still there wallowing around in mediocrity. Failure is real. It lives among us. We see it in the faces of our dear loved ones. We see it in the frustration of our parents. You watch them and you know they are frustrated. Some of them are too arrogant to admit it, so they act as though they are still in control. But many have been forced, painfully so, to admit that there is something they are missing. Many people have been forced, amplified by the recession, to swallow their pride and admit, I'm not getting something right. Nobody becomes a success by accident. Nobody becomes a success by chance, by luck. Yesterday, I was ministering at a crusade and I gave an instance. I think I've given that instance here. And I want to repeat that example. Watch this. If I make a mistake and forget that there is a step down, and then I slip and I march, will gravity forgive me and say, no, I know you were joking, you were not serious, next time be serious? No. Gravity does not have in its configuration the assumption that men make mistake. Every time I violate that law of gravity, I pay for it, and I do so immediately. And sometimes I may not have a second chance again. This is how success is, and this is how failure is. Listen, many well-intentioned people, many Christians born again and filled with the Holy Spirit, have indoctrinated themselves into believing that just because of that status, their life should succeed automatically. No. Being a Christian gives you the potential and the access for success. There is a difference between access and delivery. Access means potentials. Delivery means experience. Listen very carefully. All that Jesus Christ did for us on the cross gives us access. But there are systems built in the dealings of God with men that converts access to delivery, where you are now a manifestor of those realities. One of my very great mentors, Dr. Mike Mudock, he's taught the body of Christ for a very long time that there are two dimensions to the dealings of God with man. There are two dimensions to the approach of spiritual things. Number one, he calls it the person of Jesus. And number two, he calls it the principles of Jesus. Number one, he calls it the life of God. Number two, he calls it the laws of God. Everybody say the life of God. Say the person of Jesus. Say the principles of Jesus. And Mike Mudock teaches that the person of Jesus is what gives you that encounter that creates your peace and secures your eternal destiny with God. But it's not necessarily the key for your victory here and now. Are we together now? So I can be born again, filled with the Holy Spirit. If I die, I'm going to heaven. If Jesus comes, I'm going to heaven. I can live a life of peace, whether in plenty or lack, because his person has consumed me. I have conformed to the image of the Christ experientially. But then the dimension that is responsible for my success and victory on earth is not just the person of Jesus, but the principles of Jesus. Everybody say the principles of Jesus. That means I can be born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and yet be sick. Born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and yet be poor. Born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and yet fail in career. Born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, and become a total failure in life. Such a possibility exists. Now, most Christians have embraced the life of God, but we have ignored his principles. Are we together now? And most unbelievers have ignored the life of God but embraced his principles. So most of them are going to hell because they have openly declared that Jesus is not Lord over their lives, but they have lived their entire lives applying the kingdom, applying the principles of the kingdom. And I've taught you here in Koinonia that there is a dimension of God's power that is programmed into his laws, so that whoever obeys them will get the result, regardless of whether he has a relationship with God or not. There is a dimension of the power and the ability of God that is programmed in laws. So it doesn't matter who applies them. There are certain dimensions that are privy to only believers. It is only in Christ that those dimensions can be obtained, like peace, like the joy in the Holy Ghost. Are we together now? Like the life of Jesus, security of your eternal destiny, the ability to count it all joy when you face diverse temptations. All of these attributes are not possible to the man who has not embraced Christ. But the principles of the kingdom, the aspect that we have largely ignored, I've shared with us on my idea, and I believe that that's God's idea of spiritual growth, that there are two indices to measure a man's spiritual growth. Number one is the degree of your conformity to the image and the person of Christ. You're rising in character, you are conforming experientially to the image of the Christ. But the second dimension, the second index, is your comprehension of the mysteries and the secrets of the kingdom. Both are required together to say you are growing spiritually. If all that is happening to you is conformity to the image of Christ, that is a lopsided and a biased growth. If all that is happening to you is just access to the principles of the kingdom and you never encounter the person and the life, you will be carnal and you will never become a spiritual man. So the synergy between these two dimensions is what produces spiritual men who are relevant both in time and eternity. If that is you, say amen. Are we together? So failure is very real. I think it was a wise man, I don't know who exactly, who said, doing the same thing consistently and expecting a different result is one of the definitions of insanity. Doing the same thing and hoping and wishing that that same thing you are doing will just change results by itself, he said, is one of the definition of insanity. In other words, if your outcome is not consistent with your desire, then you have to check what you believe and what you are doing. Are we together now? Everyone say, failure is real and it's not my portion. Write this down, the word success. Let's define it. Let's look at the concept of success in the kingdom. Lord, give us understanding. Give us passion to learn. Please give us Isaiah 1:17. A scripture just came into my spirit and I want you to see it. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 17. Write this word down. Success. What is the definition of success? I'm trying to introduce the concept of success because, please look up, the body of Christ has had issues for a very long time. There are many denominations and there are many Christians, some of them looking at me right now, many listening to me online. Every time you mention the word success, especially in church and to a Christian, there is this buildup of resentment. We have associated success with carnality. We have taught and indoctrinated ourselves into believing that there are two groups of people in the body of Christ. Those who are carnal, they don't love God and want to be successful. And those who are total failures now for the sake of their spiritual growth. There's no such doctrine in the Bible. The Bible says looking up to Jesus, not up to a denomination, not up to a pastor. It's important to follow us, but be sure we are following Christ. And if at any point you are not following Christ, it is within your power to switch. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. I have shared with us again the danger of creating doctrines out of personalized dealings, that a man can have a particular bias which may be a product of his cultural limitation. Let me tell you something. Many of these doctrines that were shipped into the church, and you know I love the body of Christ, and I don't say it with any particular sense of cynicism. I'm teaching the body. And so we must realize that most of these things that have become stumbling blocks, listen carefully, many of us have inherited this from our parents, many of our loved ones, so spiritual and well-meaning, but this mindset, especially for all of us who are around the middle belt and the northern area, because of the evangelical nature of Christianity and the way we received it, we have been taught that any attention that is paid to your comfort and giving your life some sense of meaning here and now is useless. So in an attempt to emphasize the fact that we need to live with eternity in view, we have created a system of mediocrity and camped around it. So there are many lazy men who have used evangelical Christianity as an excuse to keep them lazy, keep their wives and their children in poverty and penury and suffering. There are men today who have not been working for over 20 years, and it doesn't matter. One room with your children, they were born and bred there, and he said the most important thing is this world is not our home. One day we are going somewhere. Is an expression of carelessness. So there are many doctrines that have endorsed laziness, endorsed irresponsibility, endorsed lack of productivity. So the average believer has been unable to rise to a position of kingdom influence where we can legislate on behalf of the kingdom. It's a tragic situation. Please give us the scripture again. He said, read the first four words if you are a Christian. One, two, read. Again. The word do well is the word succeed. So change it and use it well. One, two, go. Again. It didn't say be successful. It says learn. You must be taught. It says learn to do well. It's not just saying make it. Learn, be studious, submit yourself under the atmosphere and the information that will cause you to do well. When I saw that scripture, it was quite instructive. Learn to succeed. Joshua Selman, learn. It is not in you by default. Learn. The same way, where is he? Doctor. It's not a doctor by default, but you learn to become a doctor. You learn to become an architect. Are we together? You learn to become a mother. That's why when ladies give birth for the first time, their mothers or any of their guardians come around, right, and help them. They can read books and Google and search, but it's one thing to have that theory, and then all of a sudden the mother comes and says, okay, I will help you. And then helps her and she becomes strong, and then tomorrow she will help her own children. Learn. Say, I will learn and I will succeed. Say, I will learn, I will be trained, and I will succeed. Look at this. When you want to become a doctor, what do? You pass through the medical school, correct? When you want to become an engineer, what do? You pass through the engineering school. When you want to become an architect, what do? You pass through the system. So when you want to become a success, what do? Unfortunately, there is no official institution for making people successful. You see why many people are failures? There are many graduates because there are many universities. There are many primary school certificate holders because there are many primary schools. There are many prisoners because there are many prisons, and there are many opportunities for crime. But there are few successful people because there are few successful mentors, and there are few successful platforms that can help men become successful. Learn to do well. Write this down. Success is the accomplishment of a worthy goal. Write it down. The word success has nothing to do with money. It has nothing to do with all of these things. Success is the accomplishment of a worthy goal. Any goal that is ideal, that is worthwhile, when you set goals and achieve them, you are said to be successful. This is the general definition of success. The accomplishment of a worthy goal, a worthy ideal. I want to become a doctor. And then you pass through the system and you become a doctor. With respect to that goal, you are successful. I want to become a joyful mother, and you walk towards it, and then eventually you get married and have your children. With respect to that goal, you are successful. So without goals, there is no basis for being successful. Are we together now? The accomplishment of a worthy goal, a worthy ideal, is what we call success. Now let me give you a kingdom definition of success. I've given you a general definition. Let's look at a kingdom definition. Write this down. The fulfillment of your God-given assignment is called success from God's standpoint. The fulfillment of your God-given assignment, not just any goal. If an armed robber says, I must steal, and then he steals successfully, from an earthly standpoint, we say he has succeeded. But from the kingdom standpoint, he's not a success. The fulfillment of your divine assignment, the fulfillment of your God-given assignment, is called success. Another definition, the effective use, this is my own definition now, the effective use of your life, your gifts, and your resources to draw men to Jesus and bless humanity is called success. I'll take it again. The effective use of your life, comma, your gifts, comma, your resources to draw men to Jesus and then to be a blessing to humanity is my definition of success. So when you use your life like a drink offering, when you use your gifts, and when you use your resources to draw men to Jesus and then an opportunity to be a blessing to humanity, by God's standpoint and by men's standpoint, you are a success. Are we together now? The effective use of your life, the effective use of your gifts, the effective use of your resources to draw men to Jesus and then to bless humanity, to advance the purposes of the kingdom and to be a blessing to humanity. That's success. Are you blessed now? Very important. I need all of us to have this understanding so that when we talk about success, we are not talking of some money-mongering, greedy lifestyle, because this is another side of the pendulum. There are many people who are so carnal, so fleshly, the entire circumference of their Christian experience is just money and houses and cars. Everything about their understanding of God is the one who gives. My job is to just take and be rich, take and buy suit, buy designers, right? Move around the world in private jets, and then we coin that and say, this is my life. It is a very misguided, and not only misguided, destructive idea about success. That's what puts people under pressure to try to acquire things, because we hope that by acquiring things will prove a point to people. Now the truth is, if you are successful, it will show around you, but the acquisition of things is not equivalent to success in the kingdom. That you are wearing a suit of $1,000 or $2,000, you are wearing shoes, you are having estates all around, and you are a great man moving around, and people bow down to you, and people call you all kinds of names, and you have multiplied troubles, multiplied sycophants, that does not make you a success. How much you use your life, how much you use your gifts, how much you use your resources to draw men to Jesus, and then to live a life of impact, blessing your world, blessing your humanity. Every other thing, cars, houses, all these auxiliary benefits are just effects of success, not the proof of success. The proof you have succeeded is the joy in the heart of the Father. The proof you have succeeded is a life transformed, not a car in your garage. The proof that you have succeeded is somebody coming to know Jesus because you did business well. Somebody coming to know Jesus because you read your book well. Somebody coming to know Jesus because of your marriage. Somebody coming to love Jesus because of your ministry. When your life has the capacity to draw men, regardless of what area you are functioning, to Jesus, and then an opportunity to make a mark, to transform their lives, you are successful. By this definition, you will agree with me that there are very few people who are successful. There are many rich people, but they are not successful. There are many educated people, but they are not successful. Haven't seen this definition. Why then are many people failures? What is the reason? Is it that there is no access to knowledge? Is it that Satan is so powerful and can veto everything Jesus died for? Is it that if the few who are successful were just designed by God to be successful? Why do we have a whole generation as failures? A whole community as failures? I will tell you why. Because of one word, just one word, is called dishonor. I'm going to be teaching you a lot of things. We're still going to come to this issue of honor. There is one reason why any one of you here will be a failure in life. Only one reason. It's not that you didn't go to school. It's not that you graduated with a third class. No, that's a silly excuse. It's not that you are a northerner and they are victimizing you down south, or you are a southerner and they are victimizing you down north, or you are an easterner and they are victimizing you. Those are very flimsy excuses. They are obvious answers, but not correct answers. Are we together? There is only one reason why men fail in life: dishonor. Dishonor to God, dishonor to men, dishonor to principles. There's only one reason why people fail. And there's only one reason why they will remain failures: dishonor. Dishonor to God, dishonor to men, dishonor to principles. Is God helping us? Write this down. Laws and principles. Laws and principles. L-A-W-S and then principles. I want us to examine the concept of laws and principles. Jesus, thank you. Look at me. In any other and every other aspect of our lives, we believe in laws and principles. But when it comes to our spiritual lives and our destinies, we do not believe that they work by principles. It's a tragedy. It's a tragedy. Please hear me, brothers and sisters. It's a tragedy. When you go to school, you know that there are laws and principles. You are a science-based student. They teach you all kinds of science things, physics, chemistry. They teach you how to do a lot of things. They teach you what to do. They teach you laws, different kinds of laws. And the more you master those laws, the more you keep advancing. And then eventually, when you have gained certain dimensions of mastery, they award certain certificates to you. But when it comes to destiny, we have been indoctrinated into believing that we are just believers. And whether we respect laws or not, we will become successful. I will tell you where our resentment for laws came from. The imbalance and the inaccurate teaching of the concept of law and works. This is where we got our resentment for the word laws. Great men and women of God scattered across the face of the earth in an attempt, and I believe everything that they teach, in an attempt to explain or to bring the body of Christ into the reality of Christ's finished work. Listen carefully. In an attempt to show how that the old is gone, the Old Testament, you know, and that we are products of this New Testament now, in an attempt to help believers lead the victorious life, we have, from one person copying another without finding out what exactly is being said, we have drifted to another side of the pendulum. And so the average believer, especially the average Pentecostal charismatic believer, when you hear the word laws, when you hear the word principles, you just reject it. You don't even need to know law of what. You just say, no, I'm not under the law. Write this down. Laws are systems, is a system of rules that guarantee a predictable outcome. A law is a system of rules, or just a system of operation, either a system of rules or a system of operation that guarantees a predictable outcome. So laws are systems of operations. They are systems of rules that, if and when diligently applied, guarantee predictable outcomes. Write this down. Laws are a reflection of God's justice system. Laws are a reflection of God's justice system. The Bible says righteousness and justice are the foundations. It didn't say where. It never changed. Righteousness and justice are still the foundations of his throne. Laws are a reflection of God's justice system, so that nobody will say God victimized others and did certain things. No. He leaves it into your hands to define whether or not you will succeed or fail. Write this down. Laws are the keys to consistency and predictability. Laws are the keys. Please pay attention, especially those following online, wherever you are. I want you to please pay attention. Take notes if you can't. Follow us on Facebook, and we're tweeting, and then we're making posts. Please follow. I have a passion to help you understand this. Laws are the keys to consistency and predictability. Write this down. When your results do not change regardless of obstacles, then you are operating by laws. When your results, your outcomes do not change regardless of the prevailing obstacles, it's a sign that you are engaging laws. Hallelujah. So you see a ministry celebrating 36 years, a ministry celebrating 40 years. People like Kenneth Copeland, Benny Hinn, 40 something years in ministry. Brothers and sisters, that ministry was built by laws. It was not just built by emotions. Many great corporations across the world. I don't know what the oldest retail outfit is in Nigeria, the oldest restaurant in Nigeria, but we have very great restaurants across the nation of the earth, right? Like Colonel Sanders and his Kentucky Fried Chicken, and a number of people, Walmart and all of this. Some of those outfits are hundreds of years old. The founders have long been dead, but the laws kept it. Write this down. Laws make your results outlive you. Laws and principles make your results outlive you. Laws and principles make your results outlive you. Write this down finally, and then I'll begin to teach. Correct understanding and application of laws are the keys to outstanding success. Correct understanding and application of laws are the keys to outstanding success. Correct understanding, not just application, correct understanding and application of laws and principles are the keys to outstanding success. Everybody look at this. Mike is playing something. Do you know that the same way he's playing this if someone in Ghana, if someone in America plays based on whatever sequence is playing, they will get the same result because they are based on laws. Is that true? Please help me with this. This is Nestle water. How many of you know there's Nestle water in Lagos? How many of you know there's Nestle water in Ibadan? How many of you know there's Nestle water in Maiduguri? The taste is almost the same, if not the same. The packaging and everything. When you look at this one and leave and go to a shop somewhere and you look at it, you would think they took the one here, there. There is consistency in results. There is sustainability. There is predictability. There are many workers. Those who package this in Lagos may not be those who package it in another geopolitical zone, but they are all governed by the same laws, so their results are the same. Correct? Thank you. Pastor Femi, please come. My friend, please come. Two of you, please stand here. Now look how smart they are both looking. Stand here, please. Now look at this. Pastor Femi has a knotted tie, and this gentleman here has a knotted tie. Now watch this. Were you in the same room when you were knotting your ties? Did you meet yourselves? Did you know you were going to knot ties? But you took this rope, did something to it, and it became this. And you see how much it looks like the same thing. Both of them were miles apart, but engaging the same principle. And regardless of their location, the results were the same. Are we together now? Now, this tie will not say, "Lila, I'm not going to knot because I'm not in koinonia." No. If a thief knots this tie to dress smart and go and steal, the tie will not say, "You are a thief. In 2 hours, you are about to steal." I won't agree. No. Laws. Laws. If a wicked man plants maize and a tongue-talking, born-again agriculturist plants maize, both lands will produce. And in fact, this guy may even have a bumper harvest. Correct? Laws create similarity of results. So if I want to teach someone else how to be a smart gentleman like this, not in ties, I don't need to tell him, "Come and live with me forever." I just need to show him how to convert a rope, a nylon rope or a cotton rope. Are we together now? To become such a beautiful object that you can put on your neck. Thank you, sirs. So it's not just where you are. It's not just your background. There is something you do not know. You've heard me say it many times. Something I do not know is responsible for my limitation in life. How true? How true? The correct understanding and application of laws are the keys to outstanding success. We had a great time over at Bida. We rounded off the meeting yesterday, and I'm sure some of them are following. It was such a great time, as God always does in the meetings. And I had a little session with the leaders, and many of them kept asking me questions. "Man of God, what is the secret to your anointing?" And I said, if I tell these people now, they will not believe it. You see that? As I'm speaking to you right now, somebody in another meeting unconnected to Koinonia is still experiencing wisdom and the power of God at the same time. You look at a graduate from UNN, you look at a graduate from ABU, you look at a graduate from UNILAG, bring all of them together, haven't never met themselves, but they were submitted to the same laws. They will talk as though they know, they've known themselves for years. Correct? That means there is something all of us can know, that regardless of where you are, all of us will call and they'll say, "Are you experiencing the same result?" You say, "Exactly as said." Do you believe that? Honestly, if you don't believe this, just go home, because it will be that you are wasting your time this night. The goal of this teaching is to create predictability to your success. Is success important? Somebody may be asking me. Be patient and ask me 5 years from now. Remain the way you are and keep going. I will be glad to answer you 5 years from now. When you watch what happened to those who are 5 years ahead of you now, when you watch the pain, when you watch 3 children stand before you and say, "Daddy, we are hungry." When you watch your child become an armed robber simply because of failure, then you will ask that question again. Is success important? It's a terrible thing. Please be careful how you listen to people. Don't criticize men of God. Don't criticize leaders, even business experts. Be careful. Right now we have all kinds of business experts. Anyone just chokes himself with tie, holding all kinds of hilarious seminars everywhere and teaching all kinds of garbages and nonsense. And in the end of it, you are so motivated because of the rhetorics and the gimmicks that are used. And then at the end of it, you find out that your life is just an emotional roller coaster and you get back into square one. Be careful. I desire to succeed with my life. I have tasted a bit of it. It gives me joy to be able to lead a flourishing ministry. I know how painful it is to suffer and struggle in ministry. I know how painful it is to come and prepare as a man of God and not have anybody to bless. Today, by the grace of God, we are reaching several nations of the world and we are only starting. I have tasted a bit of the potency of these laws and I know they work. They will work for you in the name of Jesus Christ. They will work for you in the name of Jesus Christ. One of, I think it's Patience, I spot her here. She sent me a text, very, very funny text. And she's a student in the School of Ministry. And I've been teaching them a number of things. And then she went to Zamfara and had an opportunity to pray for someone to be filled with the Holy Spirit. According to her, she was shaking and wondering whether it will happen. And I mean, in minutes, that person was shaking and blasting in tongues. And she called me and said, "My God, look at this thing." And then she tried it on another person and it worked flawlessly. Predictability. Predictability. There are keys. Nobody is born rich. Nobody is born blessed. Are we together? He said, "In iniquity did my mother conceive me." You can live out like that or you can change. I made a decision that I will change. It's a decision that I made. And I want you tonight, if you have not made that decision, to make a strong decision. I'm taking it gradually with us because I want us to understand this. Let's define terminologies, right? We're going to define 14 words that we'll be playing around with in this series. 14 words that have been misunderstood. I don't want to make the mistake of believing that when I mention a word, all of us understand that this is what I'm saying. Write it down. The first word, I've already defined it: success, the accomplishment of a worthy goal. Am I boring you? Please write. The second word I want us to define and familiarize ourselves with is failure. What is failure? Write it down. That's the second word. I'll be very, very fast so that we can stop somewhere and pray. Jesus, we bless you. Failure is a state or condition of not meeting a desirable or intended objective. Failure is a state or a condition of not meeting a desirable or intended objective. You are said to have failed when you do not meet up to a desirable objective or an intended objective. The inability to meet your desired or intended objectives, generally speaking, is regarded as failure. Word number three, favor. What is favor? And maybe I may dwell a bit here just trying to explain a few things. Because our general mainstream definition of favor, especially in the body of Christ, is very limited. It does not bring out the substance, especially when it has to do with favor with men. Generally, we define favor as unmerited access, you know, and that is right. We define favor as grace, that is right. But let me give you three definitions of favor very quickly. Number one, favor means help, full stop. Favor means what? Help, H-E-L-P, help. Whether divine or human, favor means help. Still defining favor. What is favor? God and men contributing to ensure that you succeed. What is favor? God and men contributing to ensure that you succeed. That's favor. When God comes into partnership with you, when men come into partnership with you to ensure that you succeed, then you are said to be a favored person. God and men contributing to ensure that you succeed. Number three, what is favor? Men investing their time, credibility, and resources to help you achieve your goals. What is favor? Men investing their time, men investing their credibility, men investing their resources to help you achieve your goals. When a man invests his time, that's favor. When a man endorses you, puts his reputation and credibility on the line to make sure you rise, that's favor. When men invest their resources, be it spiritual, financial, whatever it is, to help you achieve your goals, that's favor. Never forget these three definitions. They are powerful definitions. Word number four, grace. Let's define grace. Word number four, grace. I wrote something down. I had to tear it out of my little note. I want to read it for you. One day I was inspired and I wrote it down about grace. Just pay attention as I read. Grace, as understood by many, is seen as unmerited access. Listen to me. This very confusion, exaggeration over the powerful concept of grace stems from this one definition. Okay, the very confusion and exaggeration over the powerful concept of grace stems from this one definition. A very correct and biblical definition, but very limiting. To define grace only as unmerited access is a correct definition. It is biblical, but it is very limiting and sometimes can be destructive. Grace, this is what I define grace as. No, I will tell you, just listen to me. I'm giving you my contemplations. Just listen. Grace is a multidimensional reality in the realm of the spirit and in the dealings of God with men that doesn't just refer to things unmerited, but realities and provisions that are exclusively found or domiciled and accessed from God in Christ. In other words, the definition of grace is not just limited to things unmerited, but it is also anything that comes from God. Are we together now? It is a generic expression that attempts to communicate a reality, a provision, a possibility of things not obtained from the earth realm, but from God, and only in and through Christ. Now listen, I wrote this down. This definition allows for other dimensions of grace to be captured and experienced. This morning, the Holy Spirit, okay, this is me writing, permit me, I'm reading as I just wrote directly. This morning, the Holy Spirit himself gave me the best and most concise definition of grace I have ever heard and known. And I'll tell you what the Holy Spirit told me about grace. Ready? James 1:17. This is how the Holy Spirit defined grace for me. James 1:17. Please put it up for us very fast. Let's see how we can gain time. James 1:17. This is the definition of grace. Read it. One to read. Every good and perfect, every good gift and every perfect gift that comes from above and cometh down from the Father of light, stop, is called grace. Anointing is grace. Wisdom is grace. Promises achieved is grace. Anything that is not within the jurisdiction of the earth realm that requires coming down from heaven, from the Father of light, and can only be available in Christ and through Christ is called grace. Let me finish this. I wrote something down. Every good gift, the word gift there, please leave that scripture up. Let me just explain something. The word gift there is the word dosis, and it means the act of giving. And every perfect gift is the word dorema, which means the thing given. So it talks about both the thing given and the act of giving. Are we together now? Then it says it's from above and all of that. Now this scripture shows that grace is not limited to gifts alone, but the very act of communicating things from God to men is called grace. Are you getting my point now? So that grace is not just a thing you collect. The very act of communicating with God is called grace. Now I define grace for you. Write this down. Grace is the sum total. Grace is the sum total of any and all things made available to man by God, comma. I'll take it again. Grace is the sum total of any and all things made available to man by God, but only in and through Christ. Grace is the sum total of any and all things made available to man by God, but only in and through Christ. So the anointing is an expression of grace. Prosperity is an expression of grace. Salvation, an expression of grace. Protection, all of these things are expressions of grace. Look at me. When you define grace only as unmerited access, then there is no space for obedience to be featured in grace. Are you hearing what I'm saying now? Now, when you obey and get results, it is true that what God is giving you is unmerited in that you cannot receive it. Are we together now? But being unmerited does not stop the fact that there are conditions to fulfill. The cheapest thing we get is salvation, and even salvation requires a response. You use your mouth, you use your hands, you use your legs, you use your tears. There is a participation. The gift is unmerited, but the act of receiving is merited. Are we together? Whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever does not call upon the name of the Lord, whosoever believes in him shall have life everlasting. Whosoever does not believe in him is condemned already. These are the words of Jesus. Please don't limit grace to just unmerited access. Grace is access. Definition number five. Let's hurry up. Works. Let's define works. Now that I've defined grace, I have to define works. Because if I do not define works, then there will be a lot of confusion. I also wrote something about works here. Listen to my contemplation about works and then we'll dictate. Works, on the other hand, should not be equated with action, rather certain kinds of activities. Look up, let me explain to you what I mean. Many times we have been taught, the moment you hear the word works, you just mean, I don't have any works again. You are joking. We will work for the rest of our lives. There is works. Works as defined in context to grace and in context to the Old Testament refers to certain kinds of activities that were captured in the Judaic laws and were captured in the commandments that were given to Moses, that men must do ceremonial activities to the end that they will be able to create a system of atonement for themselves. That's what was abolished. Works is not the same as action. Action is still relevant for results. Do not equate works with actions. The works of the law are different from works. What was abolished was the works of the law. I never will have to slaughter an animal again. I never will have to mediate between a priest to help me reach God. Once and forever, Christ has offered himself. The veil has been torn. That is true. But to mean there is nothing else to do in terms of action, in terms of obedience, in terms of partnership, in terms of participation is a joke. The Bible says we are saved by grace, but that system works through faith. And faith is not just believing and confessing. It's the summation of everything you do in obedience to fulfill the conditions that are tied to the results you desire. It's called faith. It's the word pistis. It doesn't just mean conviction. Conviction first, but the actions that are taken in partnership with that conviction to get a desired outcome. What are works? In the New Testament, every time we talk of works, we mean one word, obedience. Write it down. Works in the New Testament is obedience. Works in the New Testament is partnership. Please write this down. Every time we talk of works, we are not talking about going back to the law, ceremonial cleansings, and all of these rituals that were captured in the Judaic law, and then all the hilarious laws and the stringent conditions that the nation of Israel had to go through. That has been abolished once and forever. But obedience will always be a requirement. Always be a requirement. Partnership will always be a requirement. So works equal obedience to the believer today. Your partnership towards making promises manifest is what I call works. Your partnership towards making promises manifest is what we call works. We need to define this because I'm going to be playing around with these words, and it's important that all of us, when you hear it, you know what I'm saying. Number what now? Let's hurry up. I will rush now. Number six, excellence. Let's define excellence very quickly. Number six, excellence. What is excellence? Excellence means the highest level of quality available. Write it down. The highest level of quality available is called excellence. The highest level of quality available is called excellence. Another definition, surpassing ordinary standards is called excellence. So you are excellent to the degree to which you can produce the highest level of quality available. You are excellent to the degree to which you surpass ordinary standards. Can I continue? Next word, mediocrity. What is mediocrity? The quality of being average. Mediocrity is the quality of being average. Please participate. Pay attention to these words. The quality of being average. What does it mean to be mediocre? To be common. What does it mean to be mediocre? To be indifferent. The quality of being average. The quality of being common. The quality of indifference. What does it mean to be mediocre? Ordinary, like everyone else. Ordinary. Like everyone else is the attitude of mediocrity. Average, common, indifference, like everyone else. Next definition, eight. Am I right? Number eight, relationships. What are relationships? Write this down. Relationships are advantageous connections. Simple. Relationships are advantageous connections. Broadly speaking, connections. But with respect to what we are dealing with, advantageous connections. Everyone say advantageous connections. Say it inside and outside. Advantageous connections. Write this down. Usually mutually beneficial. Usually mutually beneficial. So we are talking about advantageous connections. This is my definition. That is usually mutually beneficial. That means all the parties involved in that connectivity should benefit. Relationships can be both divine and human. Write it down. Relationships can be both divine and human. It is possible to have a relationship with God. It's possible to have a relationship with Satan. It's possible to have a relationship with a demon spirit. It's possible to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. Advantageous connections. Number nine, knowledge. What is knowledge? Thank you, Jesus. What is knowledge? The gathering or acquisition of information. The gathering or acquisition of information or facts. That's called knowledge. The gathering or acquisition of information, facts, is called knowledge. Many of you are tired of writing. That's the secret to your peace. Just keep writing. What is knowledge? Awareness or familiarity. What is knowledge? Awareness or familiarity that is gained through education or experience. What is knowledge again? Awareness or familiarity that is gained through experience or through education. Can I continue? Number 10, understanding. The 10th terminology we are defining, understanding. What is understanding? Comprehension. Comprehension. In one word, understanding is comprehension. Eleven, wisdom. We're almost there. 11, wisdom. Correct application of knowledge also means accurate application of knowledge. Write it down. Wisdom is the correct application of knowledge. Also refers to the accurate application of knowledge. When knowledge is applied accurately and correctly, it's called wisdom.
Distant shores and the islands will see your light as it rises on us. Distant shores and the islands will see your light as it rises on us.
Do you know what? Do you know what I'm imagining? I'm just imagining how many of you buy me cars and houses and say, Apostle, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. No, no, look, you will be too blessed to do it. Even if you don't like me, you will do it. You will turn back. One day I'll come to your house, and when others are languishing, I will see you together with your children giving God praise and say, today is a day off. We are just worshiping and blessing his name. And people will say, are you in Nigeria? You say, no, I'm only here, but we sit on a throne and we manipulate things according to our order. Remember, I used to say this thing years ago. Believe it, oh. Believe it. I imagine you going to your mother and your father and saying, Mama, I know you did not make it in this life, but I have a surprise. Cover her eyes and take her somewhere and say, Mama, the car you did not drive, this is it. Let the devil do anything he will do. Do you think your mother will be happy? You are going to someone's house and you are seeing them want to tear your members' clothes because of rent. I must kill you now. How much is it? 250,000. That's all right. That's all right. In 2 minutes, it's there. God bless you. Not alone. I pray that God will help you. God will make this happen. Someone will step into your home and see peace between you and your children and be born again there. No preaching. And say, this is what I've been fighting. This is what I'm teaching you. If you pay attention, I don't care what tribe, I don't care what background, I don't care what is happening or not happening in your life. You listen to this, you will arise. Number 12, prosperity. Let's define prosperity. What does it mean to prosper? It means to do well. Quickly, please. Prosperity means to do well. Prosperity means to excel. Prosperity means to flourish. Prosperity means to thrive. It means to do well. It means to excel. It means to flourish. It means to thrive. That's what it means to prosper. Two more definitions and we're there. Number 13, goals. G-O-A-L-S, goals. What are goals? Clearly defined desires, objectives, and outcomes. What are goals? Clearly defined desires, objectives, and outcomes. Clearly defined desires, objectives, and outcomes. 14, the last word. Value. V-A-L-U-E. Value. What is the definition of value? Write it down. Point of difference. What is the definition of value? Point of difference. Another definition, your uniqueness. Another definition, your skill. So what is value? Your point of difference. Your uniqueness, your skill. Write this down under value. Everything that constitutes an advantage in your life and is capable of blessing humanity and glorifying God is called value. I repeat, everything that constitutes an advantage in your life and is capable of blessing humanity and glorifying God is called value. Everything that constitutes an advantage in your life and is capable of blessing humanity and is capable of glorifying God is called value. Take a deep breath. You have tried. You have been writing. Some of you, that's a key to drive laziness. You've not done this in a long time. I gave you 14 definitions that have controlled the destinies of many. I gave you 14 definitions that are capable of changing your life from tonight. I gave you 14 definitions that will be the key between your joy or your pain. Listen, I gave you 14 definitions that will make your church, your ministry, your group excel or fail. I gave you 14 definitions that will tell us what you will become. Write this down. Success is predictable. I don't need to see your results to know whether you will be successful. Success is predictable now. I can look at your life now and predict with digital precision whether or not you will succeed. There are people, I look at their lives and I know they will fail. It's a very sad truth. They will be offended and they will think, are you God? And then you see that you really fail. Failure is also predictable. Write it down. So success is predictable, semicolon. Failure is also predictable. I can look at your life, brothers and sisters, and I can know that you are going to be a very powerful prayer warrior. You are going to be a very great word addict. But I know that as far as success is concerned, you may not be very successful. I can look at your life and I know that you are going to be a very rich man. You will buy the jets and the Rolls Royces, but you will never be a spiritual man. I can look at your life and know that you may be a happy man in terms of finances, but marriage, you will pay a deep price. I can look at your life and know you are going to be a very good husband, but a very poor and broke man. I can look at your life and know that you are going to be a very intelligent graduate, but you may be jobless for the rest of your life, or you may barely be employed and remain at the lower levels. I can look at your life and know you will never rise to a managerial position. Listen, the spirit realm is higher than the natural realm, but it's not unpredictable. We look at the clouds and we can forecast with a very commendable level of accuracy that there will be rain, and it happens. A pilot tells you, we are landing at 5 minutes past one. 5 minutes past one on the dot, the tire is touching the ground. We can tame our environment with that degree of accuracy. What makes you think you need money in your account to prove you are successful? I can look at you now and know that even if 1 million is in your account, it will run away as fast as it came. You know, years ago, as I began to pursue the things of the spirit, I stumbled across materials that taught on this. I folded them with speed and threw them one side. I felt, look, let me press on this. How foolish I was. Imagine that I came for Koinonia now, and after preaching a powerful message, I now tell you, all of you, you are going to sow. My mind is not stable. I need, you have to pay my rent. I'm blessing you. The Bible says A and B and C. Everybody stand up. Worship team, you are bringing 50,000. Prayer band, you are bringing 1 million. Beggar, you are not praying for nothing. 1 million. Leaders, you are bringing 2 million. Oh, what a cost way of leadership. You will never bless anybody being a nuisance that way. God did not send me to be a nuisance to you. He sent me to bless you. Yes, it will never happen in this ministry where I will say, please raise offering for me so that I can eat well. No. You know what we call escape velocity in physics? Where you have gone past certain things. It's not pride. It will never happen again till Jesus comes. I found my way to better days. I found my way to better days. For many of you tonight, you're on your way to better days. Let them laugh at you. You're on your way to better days. Status is changed. Snowfall climb. I'm on my way to better days. Prophesy to yourself. Stars is changing. There's no more decline. I'm on my way to better days. I'm on my way. I'm on my way. For 1 minute and say, Lord, I am truly changing. I'm not just motivating myself for nothing. There is a way that can lead a man out of misery. There is a way that can lead a man out of a life of pain. There is a way that can lead a man to the wealthy place. There is a way that can lead a man to a life of impact, a life of dignity, a life of beauty, a life of peace, a life of glory. Hallelujah. Please sit down.
Thank you.
Sit down. Our time is gone. Let me teach for a few minutes and then we'll pray. Now we've had all the peripherals. Please listen, I want to teach you. You just sang that you are on your way to better days. For some of you were joking. For some of you were emotional. But for a few of you meant it. You know why? Let me ask all of you now in 1 minute. I want you to cast your mind at the worst thing you have seen happen to you and your parents. For some of you, is that you were thrown outside. For some of you, is that you had admission, but there was no money to pay it. For some of you, is that you had to go and sleep with somebody somewhere to raise 10,000 and bring back home to eat. For some of you, is that you even found yourself in occultic groups because you wanted charm for protection or success. For some of you, there are men of God probably listening to me. You have had to, under pressure, join fraternities because you are hoping that it will give you ministry connection. Listen, if you don't do anything about your success, failure will force you to do wrong things. If you don't do anything about your success, failure will force you to do wrong things. When I look at people who say, God forbid, over my dead body, I will never do this and that, I tell them, keep quiet. You don't know the pressure that failure forces people. Pressure can make you do things you never imagined you will do. I've shared with you here, I think it's in Koinonia, years ago, when I counseled a lady whose situation broke my heart and it motivated my appetite to understanding success. Her mother, true story, her mother was working with a boss and the father, I think, was not working. And then they got to a point in their life where they were stranded. I don't know if it was whatever it is, but it was a very serious issue. And the woman went to the boss to plead if she could have a raise in her salary to allow her cater for the needs of the family, being the chief burden bearer, which is very wrong, of the entire family. And according to what the lady told me, she said the boss looked at her own mother and said, you are not a small girl, you know what to do. If you want a raise, someone's mother, matured lady, you know what to do. And the mother initially refused. But when she went to meet the father, the situation, the pressure was overwhelming. Both of them agreed that the mother should go and sleep with the man. Now, yeah, I know you are. We can shout in church. Ah, I won't do it. Don't talk like that, because the person who did it is not an idiot. When somebody sits down with the head of a goat all through the night, he never planned it. That's what pressure means. When the girl told me that thing, do you know what happened? Do you know that after the man paid that woman her money, the shame, she had to still quit the job and leave. When the lady told me, I said, oh God, what is this? We're here jumping in church saying, since I was young, now I am old. I have never seen the righteous forsaken. That is such a lie. I've seen many righteous people forsaken. I've seen many of their seed beg for bread. We sing it by faith and I believe it. But I have seen many righteous people, such as our parents, such as your brother and your sister. You know them. They love God. They have been dejected and forsaken. They forsook loves and good things left them. Success is predictable. Failure is predictable. You can make up your mind from today that you are going to start a journey that will lead you into a dimension of success
You can make up your mind today that you are going to begin in a way and a dimension that you have never seen, to obey these laws and excel. Let's start with at least one or two of the laws for tonight. Ready? The laws of success. Thank you, Jesus. Ready? The first law of success, the law of relationships. Write it down. The law of relationships. Ignore this and suffer for the rest of your life. Embrace this and watch your life change as though you are holding a charm. Everybody say the law of relationships. Shout it. The law of... Write this down. Success is highly relationship dependent. Success is highly relationship dependent. Your success and my success in life is highly relationship dependent. Number two, everything money can buy, relationships can buy it. Write it down. Everything, I don't care what it is, anything at all that money can buy, relationship can pay for it. Money can buy a house, relationships can buy a house. Money can help you build a church, relationship can help you build a church. Listen, money, as you know, naira and kobo, dollars, pounds, yen, these things are not the only means of exchange. Relationship is currency. You can use it to pay for things. Relationship is currency. You can use it to pay for things. There are many ignorant people who want to be successful, but they do not know the law of relationships. So they have to look for money to pay for everything. You ask them and they tell you, I need 5 million. I need 10 million. Whereas the relationship you have is worth billions of naira in value, and it is capable of paying for anything money can pay for. There are people who have had to pay hundreds of thousands in a seminar, and another person, relationship paid for it and he entered free. Are we together now? There are people who have had to pay for rent, and others, relationship has been paying their rent. There are people who have had to pay for everything in life. Listen, if you use money to buy everything in life, you are not wise. No. It is a total display of lack of wisdom to use finances to get everything in life. It has nothing to do with being rich. That's the mistake our parents made. I love our parents, don't get me wrong. Some of you here are parents, we love you, we honor you with all our hearts. Most people think you only succeed when you start having salary, 100,000 coming. And they now say, wow, I have 100,000. Then they have a need. They ignore relationships. And something that would be cheaply paid for, they would have to look for money and pay for it. I have paid for many things in my life using relationship. Relationship like a debit card. You can use it and withdraw many other things. You can use it and pay for many other things. Relationships today, by the grace of God, has given me platforms. I am connected to people. Listen, connectivity is a key to success. You must be connected. Relationships can help you access anointings. Relationships can help you access endorsements. Relationships can help you access favor. 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 The major ingredient in success is favor. But it takes relationships.
We have come
with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words.
Hallelujah. There are things in my life I would have paid for financially. Let me give you an example. This great auditorium, an act of kindness and benevolence by CGC. We have never paid a single kobo for this venue. And some of you who are into real estate know, if you value this and we have to pay every week for all of this, imagine the millions of naira that relationship has paid for.
Yes.
Something in your life that you are hoping to change today is relationship dependent. Something, a dimension in your life you must enter now is relationship dependent. Unfortunately, for many of us, all we know is just love relationship. Husband and wife, somebody who likes a lady likes him back. That's only an aspect of it. Your relationship with God is a key to your success. Correct? You excel in life on the strength of your relationship with God. The healthier your relationship with God, the healthier your relationship with the Spirit of God, the greater your success. The prodigal son, please help me with the sound, please. The prodigal son made a big mistake. He broke relationship to look for money. Are you seeing the mistake of the prodigal son? Thank you. He jeopardized the potential for relationship. He had a relationship with his father, and on the strength of his relationship with his father, he did not pay for food, he did not pay for protection. But here's what he said: I don't want relationship, I rather want money. And he ended relationship and got money. What happened to the money? Without relationships, your finances will always be finite. There is only so much. Relationship is the secret of continual financial flow. Relationship is the secret. It is relationship that will keep finances. I'm not talking about finances necessarily, but I'm just using it as a case study. Relationships. People have blessed me today purely based on relationships. Not even as in the capacity as of a man of God, just to bless. Do you know that somebody in Zaria today has the heart to bless you, but you do not have the connection? Are you hearing what I'm saying now? Somebody has the capacity to pay for your rent without begging and without lying. Somebody has the capacity to give you free land purely based on relationship. During my birthday, people did things for me that almost brought tears from my eyes. I usually am not into celebrating birthdays and the rest. The leaders did something touching. Different people did things, but there were certain strategic blessings and things they were done that I said, God, what is this? What is this? Relationships. Relationship can give you access to realms where your physical qualification should not allow you enter there. Many of us have been trivializing relationships. That's why we keep hustling. The Bible says the labor of the fool wearieth every one of them. He does not know the road to the city. By the grace of God, I understand the ministry of destiny helpers. The ministry of destiny helpers is futile without relationship. God has used me as a destiny helper to many. God has used many people as destiny helpers to me. Hallelujah. Cheap victories that many of us lose. Cheap victories. Some of our parents do not know anybody, and so you pay for everything. And when you want to use money alone to be successful, a day will come you will have all the money in your life, and you'll find out that there are some things money cannot do. Are we together? There are people, you know, one of the greatest, this is one of the greatest lessons that I've learned from my father. My father is a man who was wealthy in relationships. I used to think he was just, you know, just someone who just likes people. But now that I've grown, I have seen the wisdom Relationship paid many bills for my father. Relationships. Let me tell you something. Relationship is an investment. The same way you invest in business is the way you invest in relationship. All this something for nothing is a joke. There are many of us, we have this self-flattery. They don't like me. You don't call me, I won't call you. Sit down there. The day you need the person, you don't call. That's when you know relationships are important. Relationships are very serious value-adding investments. There are times you will call your destiny helper, he will not respond. There are times you will send him 100 naira credit. There are times you will say, sir, just to appreciate you. You will take out time to compose a text message as if you would die there, and he will just send you one word, God bless you. But it's working. The day you now ask for help, you have set a template. There are people today, if you ever see their text, they are begging. The moment the need is met, they forget the relationships. Until the day a need arises, uncle, it's me again. No, it's junior. Say, hey, I know you are junior. What is the issue? Say, uncle, you know I'm in 400 level now. Honestly, I say, are you the first to be there? You are matured enough to start working. Uncle, we are traveling somewhere. We are going somewhere. And he says, don't be stupid. Don't you ever call my line again. Most of you, when you call your helpers, this is what they tell you. It's only when you have trouble that you call me. Anytime anybody tells you that, you need to strengthen your relationship. Many of us have very bad relationship maintenance systems. For as long, I know many great people. Sadly, some of them, even great people I know, they don't know how to keep relationships at all. Anytime you see their call, one missed call, two missed call, they're in trouble. They need a favor. They need a help. Some of you are born again, tongue talking, but you are like that. And you have closed doors. Closed doors. Your friend is celebrating a birthday you can never remember. Say, I'm too busy. Are we together now? Your whatever it is, I'm too busy. Ejimi is my friend. I love him. And you know, sometimes you see him and the wife and the two children. Of course, not everybody will have access to come and visit me. That's the privilege of friendship. Nobody is born with intimacy by default. You walk your way into it. Listen, I am a busy person. It is true. There are many people who say, Apostle, I've been trying to see you. What ordinance do I have to see you? What covenant do I have with who to see you? I've been trying to see you. You are not attending to me. That's a foolish statement. You should ask yourself, those who have unlimited access, what are they doing? That's the key. In time past, there were offices I tried to access. I've shared with you my story. Years ago, when I went to look for a loan, I won't tell you the amount. I went to look for a loan in a bank. These people wasted my time and did all kinds of things, and I found out I had brain capital but no relationship capital. And I made up my mind. Some of us, the fire is getting hotter by the day. And you think the key is to get a job, quickly find relationships. Do you know there are people who are not working, but relationship is paying them salary every month until they get a job? Yes, sir. I know people like that. My mother has a relationship with me forever. My father has a relationship with me forever. My siblings have relationships with me forever. As I rise, they rise. It's called blessed by association. Listen, once the easiest way to be rich is to find somebody building something great and invest quickly and help the person rise. And as you rise, chop, I chop. I'm teaching you. Listen, you see, the body of Christ, there are many foolish people in the body of Christ. You watch people when they are starting. You are the first to run your mouth. I don't believe in them. Now you have access to them. There are people years ago, they had access to me. They would have been some of the closest people to me today, enjoying every blessing, but they just saw it today. Now, do you know the door you enter kicking your leg, tomorrow you will feel a form? So now that God gives you the opportunity, there are people who use 50 naira to secure a relationship that is worth millions today. That's wise investment. The day that great man was looking for water, you quickly carried your 50 naira. The Bible gives us a parable, I don't have time, in the Bible, where a man
old. Listen, a man was about to be sacked by a king. Are we together? And he knew he was in trouble. He had been defrauding people, a tax collector. Now they were going to throw him away. Do you know what he did? He quickly called the people and said, how much do you owe? So amount. I reduce it for you. Ah! And the moment they sacked him, he went back to them. I scratch your back, scratch my own too. Now, this is a system that the world uses, but believers don't know this. Koinonia is very connected to several people. You see us connected to the military. We are connected to the police. We are connected to medical personnel. We are connected to politicians, because you rise through a network of relationships. You don't know which. It's not just about being selfish. It's the way it happens. Relationships. Everybody shout relationships. Some of us, if our parents knew this, some of them, their classmates today are the ministers in charge of ABC. No relationship to bless them. Is that true? Do you know there are people who sit down today and calls just come? They call them one old, promise, where are you? I'm trusting God. For what? Come. There's create one committee that doesn't make sense and say, sit down there, you are the chairman in charge of it. When God helps you after 7 months, they say, okay, that's all right, it's dissolved. Just because you must be blessed. Ask Mephibosheth how he paid for royalty. Relationships. A man who was crippled. Are you learning what I'm... Ask the disciples how they became apostles. Relationship. Even when they ran away for 3 days, when Jesus resurrected, they quickly apologized. Lord, I'm sorry, I'm still on your team. And they became apostles. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Many of you right here, you come for koinonia all the time and you have a resentful attitude. This brother, you are not my class, you are not wearing my shoe. Rather than for you to sit down and say, this brother is always taking notes, God is taking him somewhere. He may have one trouser, 200 naira, one shoe, one whatever, but what is entering his spirit is programming him for greatness. Some of you resent every other person who is not you. You are losing big time in life. Just this law alone will bless you. I am a benefactor of relationships. By the grace of God, God has connected our ministry with all kinds of people. There is nothing at this level, by the grace of God, there is nobody within our sphere of influence that we want to meet that we cannot meet. It's impossible. Somebody knows somebody. Do you know statistically, they say you are 4 people away from anybody you want to meet. 4 people. 4 people. There are others who will invite a guest minister in the capacity of his office and pay 1 million honorarium. Someone else, because of relationship, you say, no, whatever, you know, I mean, we are together. I pray for you from the depth of my heart that the power of relationships will show in your life from today. Please sit down. Many times, you see an old woman carrying firewood on her head. Firewood that is as heavy as 5 men. She puts it on her head walking. The question I ask is, where are her relationships? This mama is 70 years. She spent 70 years on earth, and you cannot build a relationship with one successful person. Listen, if you are up to 25 years hearing me and there is no one successful person in your life, you are really failing. Hear what I'm saying. You are really failing. There is nobody to run to when things go bad. There are people like that. You are a pastor, you want to hold a convention, and you are stranded financially. Nobody in your circle of influence has reason to say, please, sir, cover my shame for me. Relationships cover your shame. Relationships cover your shame. Who is standing in for you? Who is helping you rise? You go to an oil company holding your certificate and you knock at the gate, and the gate man says, yes. Say, I prayed and God led me to come and submit my CV. He says, bring it. As he collects it, he throws it inside a dustbin, and you go back rejoicing and keep seeing visions of yourself working in an oil company till you are past the age that they will receive you, because there's no relationship. Another unbeliever, let me tell you this, and I say this sincerely, this is one secret that Muslims have: relationships. Relationships. You will hardly see a Muslim child go somewhere that his father cannot create. That's why some, of course, I love them, we love Muslims and all of that, and you find out that there are some of them, you see them in your schools, they are not even serious, because they know that relationship has already had, they had the degree before they started. So this is just a ceremony for all of that to happen, because relationship has created a degree somewhere. There is a space that has been created since they were in 200 level waiting for them to occupy. But believers don't have that wisdom. I show you the life of God versus the principles of God. Are we together? There is no day in my life that relationship does not bless me. There is no day. I say it, may God forgive me if I'm lying, but it's true. There is no day in my life that relationship does not bless me. You cook by yourself. You wash your clothes by yourself. You intercede for yourself. No relationship. Nobody seen anything about you to pray for you by yourself. You are looking for favor by yourself. They drive you alone. You walk alone. You counsel yourself. You motivate. Abba. Say relationships. Say the law of relationships. I made a statement years ago, and I repeat it every once and again, that we will all be great, right? And the greater part is that we will all know ourselves. Praise God. Sorry about that. Some of you here will never have any helper. Do you know why? You are anti-friendship. Your persona is anti-friendship. You are resentful, you are rude, you are callous, you are very, very offensive in your approach. Turn and tell one another good evening, and somebody turns and you are looking at the person, you are not my class. Stop that. Oh, listen, he that wants friends must first show himself. Humble yourself in this training ground where nobody knows who is who. It's only God that knows whose destiny. You see me hug people here. Some of you see me hug our little children, and you think that I'm just hugging them. I will continue to hug them, because at their age, we're not thinking like them. That means most likely they will be better than us. At age 12, some of us were absolutely foolish. These children at age 12 pray in tongues, love God, join prayer department, some of them. I mean, look at a destiny like an arrow, and you are missing an opportunity to invest. You now come when it's too late, when the person has become a big man. Do you know there are people who call my phone all the time sending insults and saying, apostle, whatever it is they call you, you are claiming you don't know me. I say, I don't know you. I don't know you. I don't know you. Don't bully me. I don't know you. Listen, when you celebrate a great man when he's great, it's too late. You came way too late. You don't celebrate greatness when greatness manifests. You celebrate greatness in the process. You participate in it. That's why I'm excited for you, because I have the privilege of participating in your success. How in the world can I fail? Listen, with all humility, there are people today, by the grace of God that I have raised, who will never allow me beg for bread till Jesus comes. Even if I decide to be careless and I stop obeying any law of lifting. You have sat down on a, you know how they do, what they call it, let me not talk business here, all those businesses that you do, you sit down, you bring somebody and you keep rising. That's how you can sit on a chair and keep rising like that forever, because you paid the price to build someone. Are you hearing what I'm saying now? Question: whose destiny are you investing in today? Question: who will remember you when he gets to the throne? If you are not there when I'm in the cave, don't expect to be there when I'm on the throne. If you were not there when I was on the cave, don't expect to be featured. There are many lousy people in the body of Christ with an entitlement mentality. You hear them say, I knew you. I knew where you were not in. What did you do about it? When I was walking my way, when I was hungry, did you ever give me water? You were part of those grumbling and talking. And now that rejected stone has become the chief cornerstone. You are now seeing the man of God in glory and power, and you are saying we are colleagues. We are not colleagues. No, sir. Listen, be careful and don't let men bully you with their complacency and their inability to invest in your relationship. Anybody who does not think you are worth a good relationship should not be found in your future. There are people, listen, I'm rounding up. There are some of you, many people who would have lifted you, look at you now and they think you are failures because of what is happening. They gist about you. Sometimes you hear it, sometimes they say it to your face, but they don't know what it is that is happening. And then when you rise, you see them come with entitlement mentality. You should give me a house, you should give me a car, and you ask them why. They say, because I knew you before. No, sir. Everybody who believed in me when I was nothing, it's impossible for them to fail in life because they took a risk by believing in someone they never saw any result, and now their risk is yielding dividends. So it is not wickedness when you see somebody bless somebody. There are people in my life, no matter how foolish and stupid they become, I'm bound to them forever because they believed in me when I was nothing. Rejoice not over me, my enemies, for though I fall, yet I will rise again. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Some of you, in the whole of your family, nobody believes in you. They've told you to your face, you will not amount to anything. Obey these laws and watch God shock every one of them to their knees. Apostle, I want to be blessed. What are you doing? I just need 100,000 to start a business. Who fooled you that that's all it takes to succeed? You see that? You have 2 tiers of rice in your house. It can pay for a growing relationship. You can cook food, invite 5 of your friends and say, look, just to honor you guys, I know that I don't have much now, but I just love you. After 10 years, they will tell you, remember that our rice? Now enter this 5-star hotel. Let's now eat my own version of the rice. And someone looks at you. Listen, someone looks at and say, you shouldn't be in the palace. You say, I paid for it since. I paid for the palace when I could afford it. I show you wisdom keys that men are using to climb ladders of greatness. So you can see somebody in the future come. You see somebody in the future, no charisma, no anointing, yet favor will never stop leaving him. Everybody knows him. We're about leaving Bida today, and a man of God who also came for a ministration. The man of God came for a ministration. I was about to enter the car, let's go, and then the protocol stopped me and said, please, I need to attend to him. I turned to him and I said, hello, sir, I don't know you. He said, sir, you don't need to know me. I came for a ministration and I heard you were around. I stopped. The guy was holding a seed in his hand. Say relationships. There are people who will be talking, who should we lift here? And somebody will say, please, I have one daughter. I have one son, not my biological child, but this child is so well mannered, very lovely person. The person did not read this course, but that person has character, and say, send for that person quickly. You see people who read something that has no business with what they are doing, yet they keep rising to be directors. Relationships keep promoting them. Tonight we are going to pray. I will stop here. Lord, one will continue the remaining next week. There are plenty laws I will share with you. The easiest way to succeed is to invest in relationships. Relationship is a stream of income. When you are writing all your streams of income, write relationships. cost you now, because under relationships you don't sell anything, you give for free. Sometimes you need to be a fool investing in relationships. Some of you, after this meeting, you need to go and sit down and say, Lord, who are the five most valuable people in my life, and start calling them. Sometimes you don't even need five, you just need one, and say, sir, do you know there are people in my life who send credit all the time? They don't have much. It may be 100 naira. I'm not saying you should do it, but I see the passion they are making to establish a relationship with me. Billy Graham, we talk about Billy Graham as the great evangelist. Do you know one of the reasons why he was great? He had endorsements of every president. Before that happened, it was said every time Billy Graham would write letters to members of parliament and the president of the United States wanting meeting with them, they would throw away the letter. He kept doing it, and one day just one person attended to him. A day will come, the door will open. Don't think you will knock once and it will open. You see, the thing about relationship is that because of what you are looking for, sometimes it will have to sting your ego. Don't be embarrassed. Pay the price. That's the price for the value you are looking for. I see a number of men of God, sometimes they want to see me maybe for a meeting, and they come once, twice, and say, please, what is the big deal about this one? Please, we are all equal before God. And I say, what an unwise person. I have pursued men with anointings. I have humbled myself. I have stayed for weeks and months just to encounter people, and the encounter was not more than 2 minutes because of value. I have pursued uncommon mentors. I have spent money. I have sown seeds. I still sow seeds into the lives of people to maintain relationship. What have you done that you are complaining? There are people, just to stand after service and be patient, everybody is pulling their mouth. It's too late. Apostle, I need to see you specially. And I say, look, I may not have all the time. And then you see them frowning. Abba, let's respect value. No great man needs you. You are the one who needs him. So you must pay the price. Pay the price. When I meet people who have what I look for, I don't go as Apostle Joshua Selman. If it means me sweeping the office, you've had my testimony of when I wanted to take a trip to the US to go and scrub the toilets of Charles and Francis Hunter. I was not going there as colleagues. I wanted to go and scrub their toilets for 2 weeks. It pained me when they died and I didn't meet them. Relationships. How do you travel to US to go and scrub toilet? If you can, you snap yourself scrubbing toilet and put on Facebook and say it is the Lord's doing. Most people who don't understand this will say, look at how this person is disgracing himself. Never be embarrassed to invest in quality destiny relationships. There are useless relationships that are going nowhere. Cut them this night. I release the grace on you. There are people who are going nowhere and they are forcing you. You come around them, you don't love God, you don't think, you don't plan, you don't do nothing, and they say 2 weeks you've not. Leave them all. Love is a command, relationship is not. Choose your friends. It is within your power. If you are not going where I'm going, I love you, but you have to stay. We can greet in church, we can greet around, but you cannot be my destiny friend not having my convictions. A man who has to make you change your conviction in his presence is not a destiny friend. Leave them. Who are you believing in right now that you have not seen anything in their life? Who are you believing right now? Some of these people, some of them are outside. They may be sitting, smelly clothes. They can't afford perfume, torn clothes, but they are receiving. You can reject them because of the privilege that you have. And tomorrow, you did not know that that was your governor you were kicking away. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you did not know your time of visitation. Your time came and you allowed it to pass you. We are going to cry to God tonight. Father, I want to engage the law of relationships. Stand up. Please pray. Rise up on your feet. I'd like you to thank God for this message. We just started introducing it tonight. Lift your hands and thank God. Open your mouth and say, God, thank you. You are revealing to me the keys
You are revealing to me the keys. You are revealing to me the keys. You are revealing to me the keys. Shalabarato kasabla digale malala. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. Come bigger. Many of you don't know this gentleman. You see this guy? This guy would never fail in life. Ask me why. Because when we started, listen carefully. When he and I started, the time we used to meet in the campus and sit on his lap, and this gentleman, the same way he's holding his guitar, that's how he was a person who was holding the guitar and playing. And he will, everybody usually will be seated when it's time to preach, but he will have to stand with me. There's another dear lady, she was the one who would hold light for me. That's her work. She did it joyfully. Bring her torchlight. Every time I was going to read a scripture, she would do it joyfully. Those two people will never, never beg for bread, not when I'm alive. Yes, no, 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 it's not amen. It's a reality. I'm serious about it. I can mention names of people. I told you about my principal who I went to visit early this year, and I looked at him. He had become an old man now. And I said, God, in my lifetime, please let me build a house for this man and buy a car for him and bless him with a seed that brings tears from his eyes before he goes to meet the Lord. It's a covenant I made with myself. What did he do? He believed in me. I remember seeing me as a young boy, and he looked at me and said, you are smart. He had a little keyboard and he called me to come and sit down. And I had come from a background of so much complex and pain. He made the entire school to gather in front of me, and he said I should play keyboard for them. And that was the beginning of the healing process for inferiority that today nations are getting blessed from. I was not born this way. Never forget those who believed in you when you were nothing. You see, let me tell you something about greatness. As you start rising, levels will change. Don't let your mind change. Because you will start seeing sycophants, people who you meet on the journey, and they are there to make it look like at your level. Should you now be relating with these ones? This woman used to sweep your house. Now you have become a big woman. You are even going to marry a millionaire. Just find 2,000 and let her go away. Please, this smelly woman, not your class. A wise person will say, if she could sweep my house when I had nothing, she deserves to sweep my palace. She even deserves a palace of her own. Relationships. Anything money can buy, relationship can buy it. You have been paying for too many things using finances. Start using relationships. Lift your voice and cry. Because God bless you, I love you. Thank you. Lift your voice and say, Lord, connect me. Connect me. Connect me. Pray. Connect me. Shato salaka de bregedia. Shaprokoto salabakaria. I know our time is gone, but pray. I'm handing to you keys that will make your life remarkable. Man of God, pray for relationships. Strategic relationships, covenant relationships. Pray. Hallelujah. I like you to pray and say, Lord, take away the spirit of offense, because offense is the killer of relationships. Hear me. Your friends will never be perfect people, just like you are not. There are many of you, your son, you can never have a friend for 2 weeks and not talk about A to B and talk about B to C. It's a devilish attitude. I'd like you to pray and say, Lord, take that attitude out of my life. Bitterness on offense. Grace to forbear. Grace to endure the weaknesses of my destiny friend. Grace to endure the weaknesses of my valuable friends. Pray. Pray. Grace.
Pastor Femi, come. Many of you don't know why you see me stand with Pastor Femi. It's not just because Pastor Femi is my son in the gospel. Let me tell you. Do you know before he became a pastor, Pastor Femi used to be the one to carry equipment for worship team. This worship team you see. He would carry the equipment and sit down in Rema Chapel. They will finish rehearsal. He will help to close and God was watching. God was watching. Foolish people were saying you are wasting time. Why are you human worship? And God was watching. God does not lift proud people. God lifts those who can serve with their heart and their life. Gradually, occasionally he would play bass guitar. Humble himself. Even when he became a pastor, there were times he was playing bass guitar. One day I had to tell him, no, it's okay. The person assisting him now, Francis. Francis is the friend of Charles. Francis was in protocol. Look at how God is lifting people except you. God is lifting people except you because pride has still kept you where you are. Big manism. There are people who humble themselves to serve. There are people in this ministry. The level of grace they have, they can be geos of great ministries. Yet you see them doing very frail activities. Some of them are in protocol, running around. He resisted the proud. He gives grace to the humble. You see what God has done in his life today. God bless you. Aaron, come. Let me use you. Come, Aaron. Many of you do not know that the first person who was the protocol of ENI was Aaron. This gentleman you see standing here. When we were doing crusades, nothing to write home about. Owing everybody everywhere. Just moving by faith. It was Aaron who was in charge of logistics and buses. I remember shouting at them and pushing them and all of these things. This guy you see, Aaron. Yet till today, the way he is, you still see him greet some of the leaders. Some of these people are young. They are younger than him by far in age, younger than him in experience and all of that. And you see him still act. And where there is an opportunity, you see him serve with all his heart. Aaron is one person who has served me and served God with his life. And I've made a vow and a covenant, no matter what happens, I will never watch him and his children beg for bread. Thank you, Aaron. I love you. Question. A few years from now, who is going to call you? Do you know Ejimi's wife, this lady you see, as of 2010, she was a member of protocol. Protocol, when we're doing Kingdom Wealth Summit, had not married her husband yet. Protocol, serving with all her heart, establishing quality relationships. Today, look at their children, all copying what the parents are doing. You are allowing time to pass. God is sending strategic people to your life. You insult everybody who is not you. You are out to look for imperfections. This lady is too loud. This person is too this. It is true they have those issues. But can you ignore it and see that God is connecting you with a ladder that will wipe your tears forever? Our parents ignored it. And today they keep frowning at televisions when they see their colleagues. Pray in 1 minute. Open my eyes to see those who are my destiny helpers. Open my eyes to see the relationship I must protect at all costs. Open my eyes, oh God, to see the relationship. Not all relationships are worth keeping. Not all relationships are worth protecting. But I tell you, there are relationships that are worth keeping forever. Assignment. As you go back home today, or tomorrow, go and write the list of the 5 most vulnerable relationships in your life and begin to invest unashamedly in them. 5 people that God has brought in your life that you know you need, no matter what it is. You don't have to invest in everybody. There are people after 20 years, it's still a waste. But let me tell you, there are relationships you must protect at all costs. Some of us are penny wise and pound foolish. We can destroy today or try to enjoy today. We destroyed a relationship that is long lasting. I have seen people, I have counseled people who destroyed relationship with great people over trivial matters. Matters of marriage, matters of money, matters of job, matters of reputation, matters of ego. Broke great relationships with people. I know great men today who have vowed in my presence that they will never help certain people because of their attitude.
There are times that the prices of things are high, but we are happy paying for them because we know that there has been development to a level that will commensurately pay you. Is that true?
Yes.
Competence. Reject mediocrity. Write it down. I reject mediocrity. You have to write it, personalize it. Don't say we reject. This is not a corporate thing. You must reject it personally. There are many believers who are not competent. Apostle, I make hair. Pray for my salon. Someone comes to your salon, you burn their hair, you charge high, you finish late. You are frowning, heat is killing them there, and close to the television is one bottle of anointing oil there. Very dirty, dusty around. Dirty place, the gutter is smelling, there's a bottle of minerals close to that gutter, and you say, please, pay 100 naira for it. And the person says, what is your idea of me? Just because I came to spend 3 hours to make my hair? Praise God. People have traveled from region to region to go somewhere and be able to buy certain things because they are looking for quality. Let me tell you, not everyone is afraid of quality. There are people who have conquered price. What they are looking for is quality. Did you hear what I said? Yes. Oh, but if I put quality, everybody around my area cannot pay for it. You don't need everybody. One person can equal 200 mediocres. One person who likes you. Pastor David Ibiome was sharing and saying that he noticed that those who sold his clothes, they will collect measurement of 11 and sew 13. He said they will never return back to him again. But then one, they would sew 3 clothes, the same measurement. One will look as if, you know, and then the other one, he said, what sort of people are you? You are not competent. And some of them were members of his church. He said, no, I love you, but I can't use you. Then he found somebody who charged twice the price. And he looked at the person. And he said, why are you charging twice the price? And the person said, sir, I know what I can deliver, according to him. And he says, okay, I'm impressed. Let me give you a trial. He said, when he came back with that clothes, David Ibiome said, that's it. You are the one who sold my traditionals. Now, one David Ibiome is worth some cities. I think I like that kind of business. Why labor to get 222 naira from everybody when I can get 1 million from one loyal person? Don't allow environment make you compromise on quality, because impressions are important. You give a negative impression about your shop. The day you change, people will still think you are like yesterday. You now went for a 3 months tailoring school, and now you have become a pro tailor. But everybody looks at you and says, don't waste your time going to that woman. Do you know, God is my witness, I once saw a wedding cloth, Ejimi, a lady's wedding gown. I never would believe they sold that thing in Nigeria. I thought it was maybe, you know, London School of Tailoring or one of these Gucci or Versace and all of that. And they told me the tailor made a tailor in the north here. I mean, with a level of precision.
Now, those people are not noisemakers. You may not see them on Facebook, but they are the types, if you call them, they don't even pick your call. If you are ready to spend 500,000 on a wedding gown, get to them. In a year, they sold for 100 people only. They are building estates, and other people are there saying, it depends on your level, which type. If you want for 10,000, I can sell. And then a night to the wedding, that's when they bring it. And it's raining. You can't wash it. They bring a white wedding gown that is smelling fabric, is bad, is torn. They say, you know, you didn't finish paying me, self. You spoil another person's wedding simply because of incompetence. And he said, please, if you know any other person, bring. No, nobody does that. Listen, excellence is self-marketing. Excellence is self-marketing. Being excellent to one person is the same as attracting 100 people. The money you will use to attract 100 people can be saved in creating an excellent outcome. Everybody say excellence. Look at me. There are many of us right now. What you are writing on, what you are writing on, is a piece of paper that you could not even tear orderly. That is a piece of paper is an issue, but the discipline to just tear it and create synergy, you don't have that patience. You just tear everything and you are writing something that will change your destiny. You're not excellent. You see, excellence is a culture. It starts from your life. You don't try to pretend it outside. You eat, you don't wash the plate. You are not excellent. You wash the plate, you don't throw away the dirty water. You are not excellent. You use the same soap to bath, wash, clean, mop, or the same rag, your sponge case for your shoe. You are not excellent. Are we together? Don't laugh at anybody. God is speaking to you. You enter to bath like I was teaching school of ministry students. Some of you bath in 1 minute. They ask you a question. You are answering it while you are bathing. You will think you are flushing the toilet. You just hear, shwa, and you are out. No, you are not excellent. Sir, you are not excellent. Are we together? Wearing one boxer for 2 weeks, you are not excellent. Wearing one torn singlet, smelling it to see if it's still usable, you are not excellent. Ironing clothes with sweat on it and seeing it rise, and you are not excellent. Are we together? You are laughing. Ask those who this thing has cost them so much. Do you know, just there are people. Someone like me, I eat emotionally before my mouth touches it. Presentation matters as much as what it is. You don't cook nonsense and say the most important thing is your body. No. Why did God give me eyes? Are we together now? You have a restaurant. I carry your spoon. Somebody took Gary with the spoon. And you, obviously they were washing it in a hurry and you see the trace. Why should I remain there? Let's tell ourselves the truth tonight. Success systems. There's oil all around. They have to call you, madam, come and clean this table now. You just send one lady who frowns around, comes out as if everybody has offended her, just pushes the rag across the table. Pours the water on you and goes. Madam, give me rice, beans, towel, and one other part. She goes to go and bring swallow. No attention to details. After 20 or I'm showing us little things, no attention to details. Iron someone's cloth, you go and burn the cloth. You don't know how much the cloth is. I say, sir, I remember one guy who wanted me to start doing dry cleaning with him, and so he said he wanted to do something. I said, okay, let me try you. I gave him a suit. He returned it after like 1 month. I don't know what he did on it. I said, thank you. I gave it to somebody, and I knew that even he knew that he had lost that opportunity forever. Let's stop saying God is not looking down on us. I'm showing you how God comes, but we cannot receive because we don't understand his systems. One day I will cook for the governor. Who are you with what you are doing now? You are not training yourself. The governor is not an idiot. The government house is not a zoo. If you want to cook well, you must be competent. Don't throw anything at anybody. Are we together now? How about barbers? How about barbers? How about barbers? There are people who pay as much as 4,000-5,000 just to barb their hair. You think they are lavishing money? They are not ready to risk their hair. Are we together? You bring out a clipper, you don't even know whether it's sharp or not. You injure someone all around because you are barbing. Don't laugh. These are ways that anything can take you to the top if it's excellent. It's not just shell. It's not just oil and gas. It's a determination to be thorough. Pay attention to details. Listen to the instructions. No assumption. You met somebody. God is introducing a great businessman to you. About to take a risk with you. He says, call me by 2 p.m. tomorrow. It's by 1:30 you sleep. Are you a serious person? You get up and start ringing his phone by 4. I say, no, you have to pray. Apostle, this guy is not picking my call. Why should he pick your call? Maybe that guy is in church for evening service. Maybe he's a deacon. You are ringing by 7. You are ringing his number. He told you, call me by 2. Someone tells you, I want to give you a job. I want to help you. Come by 2. You stroll carelessly by 2:30 and say, uncle, just to let you know I'm around. No, you won't get the job. Because some jobs, the lives of people are dependent on it. Excellence. You have one shoe, you polish it, you comb your hair well. Don't dress around like a thief going to the house of God. You look smart. Say, I'm not a man of God. It doesn't mean you should be like that. You are smart. It's not about having money. Excellence. Your notebooks, you bind them well. If they are torn, you fix them. You fix your Bible. Are we together now? Your environment is neat, very neat. We come into your kitchen, we see it neat. We come into your toilet, we see it neat. We come into the living room, we see it neat. That's excellence. Don't say we were not trained that way. That's why God is bringing you. Koinonia is a school and you are learning. Are we together? Is God helping us? The law of competence. How to be competent? Quickly. Now that I've challenged your mediocrity, how do I become competent? Number one, you must have a reference. You cannot be excellent and competent when there is no reference. A reference means an individual that reflects your aspiration. There must be someone, even if you plan to surpass that level, there must be a reference. Oh, I want to become a great worship minister. I have a reference like Don Moen. Now, that gives you a standard to start climbing the ladder. When you become like Don Moen, you now earn the right to go higher. But not when you are down. I want to be great. Like who? I'm unique. Oh, yes, you are unique. But you need a reference. The Bible says, ask for the ancient parts. That means someone walked in it before you. Are you hearing what I'm saying now? You must have a reference. Look at me. Hold on, Mike. If you do not have a reference for ministry, for business, you want to become a great man of God, like who? Who represents a model? Because that's the life you are going to understudy. That's going to be your case study. I want to become a business mogul, like who? You just mentioned one hilarious name. How many videos of that person do you have? Have you ever gone for a seminar organized by that person? No. Competence and excellence is based on a reference. I always challenge every department in this ministry to have a modern ministry who reflect their aspiration. So every department has a reference that they can look up to for inspiration. References are important because we draw inspiration from them. If your reference is small, your outcomes will be small. You see, when your references are people of mediocrity, you will hit it too fast, even when you don't do much, and so you will not aspire to rise. Number two, how to be competent. Submit yourself to mentorship. Now that you have references, I told you last week that mentorship and training is the only way to be successful. Trust me when I say this. Mentorship is not listening to a man. Mentorship is submitting yourself to build the character, the traits, the habits, the principles, and the secrets of a man. Submitting yourself to build the character, the traits, the habits, the principles, the secrets. I take it again. The character, the traits, the habits, the principles, the secrets of a man. That's what you do when you are receiving mentorship. It's not just to go and package yourself for nothing. No, you sit down. Why is this person getting these results? What is he doing that I'm not doing? Why does Benny Hinn stand on stage and 40 people rise up on the wheelchair and he has not started praying? Is it that God is unfair to me? God, you called me to have the healing anointing, but what is it about? What's the difference between me and Benny Hinn? Then you study his prayer life. You may never have that close access to him, so you take advantage of his materials. You know, a lot of people call me and say, sir, I want you to mentor me. Can I be calling you anytime? I say, no. He says, sir, so how do you mentor me? I said, that's why I'm teaching. I'm teaching all the time. There's Koinonia Radio. Our teachings are free. Listen, they say, I have it. I say, that's why you will never learn. Mentorship is not listening to a radio program or a TV program. I've shared with a school of ministry students, there are times it takes me 3 days to watch a 1 hour video. 3 days to watch a 1 hour video, because almost every two minutes I'm stopping. This man said this. I have to listen. That's mentorship. You submit yourself to read between the lines. Ah, he just said the power of God will touch somebody outside and somebody was shouting. How did he know? Was that the word of knowledge? Man, this guy is powerful. That's excitement. That's not mentorship. There are too many excited people who just see results and don't know the secrets. I was told, I don't know if it's true or not, but I was told one great man of God, Bishop Abioye, that one time one man said he wanted to, you know, find out the secret of his prayer life. And he said, fine, let's pray. And that they prayed. After a long time, the guy was yawning. He wanted to sleep. And then Bishop Abioye told him, okay, we've given thanks. Now let's pray. And the guy was almost dying. If that story is true, that guy is not wise. What do you think the anointing is? You think the anointing is a charm? Even a charm, go and ask a herbalist the price for a charm that can throw a man down. Not giving miracles, just push a man against gravity. The secret of great men is in their stories. Pay attention when a great man is giving you examples. Pay attention when a great man is giving you stories. They are trying to bring a principle. Many people laugh at the stories. Parables and mysteries enshrined in stories. You can see the stories and laugh and be raptured by the humor of the communication and miss out on the meaning of it. I'm not against laughing, be happy, but you must be able to see when others are looking. Are we together? Submit yourself to mentorship. Number three, understand, believe, and live by the principles learned. How to be competent? One, you must have a reference. Two, submit yourself to mentorship. Three, understand, believe, and live by the principles learned. It's not enough to just say, I know he told me this. Understand what you have been taught. Believe what you have been taught. Let me tell you something. I have discovered something with the body of Christ. Many people who supposedly submit themselves to mentorship don't believe half of what they are being told. When you don't believe a man, don't ever listen to him for mentorship, because you'll be wasting your time. You have a right to vet a man. And do you believe this? Don't sit down and you are not complice. You are not producing any result, and you are there and someone is teaching on the anointing. I say, no, I don't. Just because he made a mistake with one Greek word, he said, no, I have the modern lexicon. Oga, who did you get out of a wheelchair? Whose eye opened? That's the summary of this thing we are talking about. Whose eye opened? Whose life changed? You prophesied on somebody, everything was wrong. Sit down. Sit down. Don't just say the person does not have faith. You are messing up. If it's not working, it's not working. Sit down. When I see people who communicate dimensions that are not at work in my life, even if I don't exactly understand what they are saying, I sit down and try to discern the spirit of what they are saying. Because sometimes it may be that they are not able to communicate. Maybe a businessman, a smart businessman who is, let's say, he's somebody who is not very, he just used street sense, but in that street sense he kept acquiring principles. Now he may be sharing business secrets, he may not intelligently articulate it like someone who went to Harvard Business School will, but you can discern the spirit of his communication. Not to sit down and say, "Kai, this carpenter now, wow," but he's the number one carpenter. Do you know why rich people are coming to him? Maybe the man, every two months he will package a seed and squeeze it and take it to his reverend. That may be his edge. While you are listening to him, one day in passing he will reveal a secret and say, "That's my pastor. Let me tell you something. See that man is powerful." Say, "Talk to me." Say, "I used to, the only thing I used to make before was coffin, and then one day he called me, prophesied to me. Now I make bed, I even have a timber shed." Now he did not say it intelligently, but you have picked a principle. Years ago, I was in Abuja and I took a cab. When I took a cab, we were discussing with the driver, because sometimes I crack jokes with them. Say, "Ah, Oga, you who are enjoying this, my chama and Abba, I'm not enjoying." And then we're talking about money. And then later the man said, "Oga, you know, say this money, that the thing has a spirit." And then I started listening to him. He said, "Do you know that he tried to build a house in Abuja? He tried and tried, could not build. But he said he saved and took the money out of Abuja, and in 4 months he built." I discerned something that guy was saying. He was communicating a deep mystery, but because of the barrier in communication. Are we together now? Listen, if you don't have results in your life, you are not a colleague to the person who has results. Sit down, humble yourself. Believe, learn. If you don't believe, it will not work for you. You don't only believe the principle, you must believe the communicator. Are we together now?
Yes.
A woman didn't go to school, she's taking care of 10 of her children, and you are there. "I am a lawyer, I'm a barrister." And the madam is saying, "Let me tell you this, I flogged my child from age 1 to 7. When my child was in my womb, I was anointing my womb with oil." Now, he's not saying you should repeat the anointing. Discern the mystery of what she was saying. She may now tell you that, "I took one night vigil for all my children before they were born." You are now learning secrets. You apply the same thing and change any dull head in your life to an intelligent child, no matter what the limitations are. Listen, one of the greatest ways of receiving mentorship is observation. Don't wait for a great man to tell you everything. There are people who look and say, "Is this all?" There are people who have never seen, but observe. You observe. When the power of God is about to come, how does he behave? Observation. Observation. Jesus was speaking to them and said, "You can look at the clouds and through observation know that it is rainy season." You can learn a lot through observation. Every time you enter the presence of a great man, be observant. You see him keeping laws. Oh, somebody disappoints him and he doesn't quarrel the person in public. He says, "Okay, that's all right. We'll go and see." Oh, Oga, the poor man now wants to kneel down and says, "All right, let's go." You are learning. You are the one who quarrels your house help in front of everybody. And before you know it, they start calling the house help the name you are calling. you insult your wife in front of everybody. Don't mind this useless woman. Very soon your friend will say, that's why he's calling you a useless woman, because you are making men reflect what you are communicating. Principles. Say, I receive grace to be observant. Say it again, I receive grace to be observant. And then number four, the fourth way to be competent, remain connected. Never disconnect from those who lift you up. It's foolishness. A time may come in your life you feel you don't need them again in terms of the dynamics of what they are teaching you. But that's when great men fall. No matter how tall a skyscraper is, it remains for as long as it's still connected to the ground. There's no skyscraper that says, I am 500 meters into the air, I can disconnect. No, sir. Are we together? Yes. Are you learning? Let me give us two more laws and then we'll be done. Is God helping us? You know, look at this. Let me tell you this. If you're a businessman, listen twice to what I'm teaching you. And everybody's in business, I hope you know. Business is simply solving a problem for an agreed reward. It's not wearing suits and sitting in business class. Business is solving a problem for an agreed reward. Simple. Most men think men of God don't know anything about business, you know. When they look at men of God, they just feel we are just daft people. You are praying and fasting, you don't know anything. See, still this pride we are talking about. What do you think managing people is? What do you think managing resources are? What do you think multiplying them is? Are we together now? The law of the mind. Number what? Number four. Am I right? Five. Thank you. Number one is, I'm the one teaching, listen. Number one is the law of relationships. Am I right? Number two, the law of value. Number three, the law of competence and excellence. Oh, that's true. How to be competent is part of it. Number four, the law of the mind. Jesus. The law of the mind. Proverbs chapter 23 verse 7. Is God helping us? As I teach you, you should be seeing the loopholes. What laws you are not keeping that is deactivating the systems of success in your life. 23 verse 7, Proverbs. For as he thinketh in his heart, it's interchanged with the word mind, so is he. Not so he will be. As you are thinking, you already are. The Bible creates your references your physical reality to what is happening in your mind. The Bible says in Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart. Proverbs 4:23, guard your heart with all diligence. It says, for from out of it are the issues of life. Guard it. It didn't say guard your head. It didn't say guard your legs. Guard your heart. You don't cover yourself, the worst is you catch cold and mosquitoes can disturb you. But you don't protect your mind, you will fail in life. Listen, being filled with the Holy Spirit does not negate the need to transform and build your mind. The law of the mind. What does it state? As it is in your mind, so it will be in your life. As it is in your mind, so it will be in your life. Trust me, your physical reality is a merciless reflection of the summation of your understanding, your thought patterns. As it is in your mind, so it will be in your life. A great mentor says, you become what you think about. How true. You become what you think about. Your life is a reflection of your most dominant thoughts. Your life is a reflection. The quality of your life today is a reflection of your understanding about God, about life. The quality of your life today is a reflection of your paradigms. Are we getting blessed? The mind is a mystery that I want all of us. We've had several teachings here on the mind, but it's important for you to understand the mind. My life changed. This law alone changed me like day and night. The law of the mind. That the quality of my life today is a reflection of my mind. Your mind is a miracle. Your mind is a gold mine. It literally is. Literally is. Literally is. Write this down. Your mind is an extraordinarily fertile garden. Your mind is an extraordinarily fertile garden. Full stop. Write it down. Your mind is an extraordinarily fertile garden. It will grow any seed planted and watered. It will grow any seed that is planted and watered. In agric science, they teach that there are several kinds of soils. I don't know if they've discovered others, but as far as I remember, they taught loamy soil, clay soil, what other one? Sandy soil, and every other auxiliary one that comes as a combination of them. Your mind is a perfect garden, sustaining the ability to grow any seed that is planted and watered. No matter what is planted in your mind, if it lands on that soil and you water it, and I'll tell you how to water it, it must grow. Unfortunately, it does not grow in your mind, it grows in your life. You plant it in your mind, it grows in your life. Look at your life, the summation of everything in your life, your finances, your peace, your understanding, your excellence, your relationships, everything in your life is a sum total of your paradigm. It's an uncomfortable truth. Many people will not want to admit, but it's true. Apostle, nothing is working. No friends in my life, no favor in my life. There is an inaccurate understanding or a poor understanding you are sustaining. Listen, your ignorance is a seed. You can plant it in your mind and it will bring you a bumper harvest. Let me tell you what ignorance produces: pain, frustration, disappointment. These are all harvests of the seed of ignorance. It's rainy season all the time in your mind. Your mind has no dry season. It's rainy season all the time. Capacity to produce anything. There's no barrenness with the mind. There's only wrong seeds planted in the mind. And I'm standing here only because you made a way, made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because sing it one more time. That can happen to you outside of salvation is not the healing of your body. Listen carefully. There are people with no legs who are changing the world. There are people with no eyes who are changing the world. But there is nobody with an unfruitful mind who can change the world. The worst thing that can happen to a man is not his eyes missing, not the legs, not the mouth. There is a scientist, I don't know his name, who had a disease that literally crippled him. yet he's one of the smartest scientists in the world. Nothing else in your life is worth crying for till you lose your mind. The worst sickness in life is madness, not blindness. Not blindness, madness. If I give you 1 billion and I make you mad, have I blessed you? Please talk to me.
Yes.
There are people who have built empires. In fact, there's a book like that, Empires of the Mind, and it's worth reading. Very powerful book. You have to learn and understand this mystery called the mind. Many believers are not interested. Like some of you probably are. As I'm talking now, you're like, oh, mind, bring another thing now. Look, you will never be great. I'm sharing with you the principles that I have lived by. You have seen the anointing and the grace of God upon my life. I'm showing you the other sides to these success systems. Because many people just think, oh, these people are just privileged. No, sir. These are systems. They make your life and your outcome predictable. You never truly rise above your mindset. You never truly rise. Underline the word truly. You never truly rise above your mindset. You may jump above it for a while, but I assure you, you will never truly rise. Your life will only rise to match the level of your mindset, no matter how you manipulate it. Your mindset is what shows the quality of your life. I wrote down something here I want you to listen to. I don't know if you can have the speed to write it, but listen first. If you attempt to change your life without changing your mindset will compel behaviors that will force your life to return back and reflect the level of your mind. You know how you pull a rubber ring? You can pull it and it becomes elastic, and you think it will remain like that. The moment you push it, what happens? It returns back. That's how many people are. If you attempt to change your life, change your shoe, change your suit, change your hair, change watch, change cars, and all these mundane things that we use around to prove that you are successful, you attempt to change them first without changing your mind will cause them to disappear until your life returns back to the level of your mind. See, I have seen this thing work too many times. I've given this example here, I believe. Have you seen someone that you used a dress for 1 year and people would think you just sold it because the dress is reflecting the quality of your mindset? That maintenance culture of excellence reflected on the dress. Carry it as a gift and give a tongue-talking, careless believer who is not prepared to work on their minds. Give them 2 weeks. You know what you see? The shirt will reflect their mind. They won't iron it. They won't wash it. The color will change. They won't care. It will tear. They won't sew it. Later on, you will check and see that they now use it to wash a car. 2 months. Hollandis that you spend money to buy, you decided to sew it in 2 months. They are using it to wash motorcycle. That's the mindset. So that person's mindset changed that fabric to come back to the level. In my life, I've had the privilege by the grace of God to bless people financially. Usually they come and they tell you, sir, I have an idea. I have this. If you only give me this money, I will never return back. And I look at them and I say, what is your idea of success? Because you think all you need to be great, and I'm correcting many of us here right now, because there are people about to make that mistake. You think all you need is 100,000, 200,000. If it left you, it is not your hand that took it away. It's your mind that took it away. So you must correct something in your mind first before having it back. Are we together now? The most difficult person to help is the man who is resistant to positive mental transformation. The most difficult person to help, the most difficult person to help is the man who is resistant to positive mental transformation. The moment you find a man who is resistant to change in terms of mindset, you have found a man who has defined himself as being hopeless. I have seen great people rise and didn't pay attention to rise first in the mind. I've seen people inherit money. I've seen people win lottery, millions of dollars, and their mindsets created behavioral patterns that drove everything away from them. Having physical things without a transformed mind is like having a Jeep without knowing how to drive. It's not if you will have accident, it's when. Are we together now? You can manage to navigate your way driving nonsense and arrive safely, and then one day you decide to park passengers and travel. That's the day you die. You see that? And you can die the death of a fool. Listen, packaging without mental upgrade will lead to frustration. Write it, Nigerians. Packaging without mental upgrade will lead to, I was almost saying like lead to Nigeria, will lead to frustration. Packaging, you know what we call packaging? Paying attention to the physical form. Now it is important. Appearance is important. Appearance is the seed for acceptance. So don't ignore. Appearance is important because it is the seed for acceptance. Joseph had to shave his beard to stand before Pharaoh. So acceptance is the seed. I mean, appearance is the seed for acceptance. However, packaging, having physical things around you. Now listen, many of us young people have a very big, there's a big mistake we're making. Everybody wants to buy a car. Everybody wants to buy a shoe. Oh, that great man is wearing Versace, is wearing Gucci, wearing Louis Vuitton, and me too, I want to get all these designers. I want to, and then you now try and save and save and beg and steal and raise money, and then buy the shoe, buy the hair, buy everything. So physically you look, let me tell you something, a great man and a great name are not the same. If your name is greater than you, you are in trouble. You must rise to get to the level of your name. I will make your name great does not mean you are great. It's a disappointing thing for your name to be greater than you. God makes your name great as an act of mercy so that you can quickly catch up. Are we blessed? The law of the mind. There's too much packaging. Packaging. I know people who years ago, as students, were behaving like bankers. A student will buy a suit of 40,000. A student will not cook. No, I don't have that time. I don't like okra soup. Do you have that option? No. Whoever pays creates the rules. Somebody cannot pay and you say, I don't like okra. There are people who try to live a life. You have not built your mind. There are so many people holding briefcases today. Arrogant people. You see them, they move around wearing suits, loitering our streets. You ask them, what do we do? Say, it depends on which company. I have 5 companies. I'm the CEO of this. What do you do? Well, we are into logistics. What do you mean logistics? Logistics is like saying I'm studying science. What do you do? I'm into real estate. What do you know about real estate? Well, my uncle gave me one land to sell. You are not into real estate. Are we together now? I am this, I'm into that. I'm one of, in fact, by the grace of God, it's just that I don't want to talk too loud. I'm one of the top fashion people in this town. Who knows you? Who has patronized you? We make too much noise, whereas our results cannot match it. It is better for people to have a low expectation over you and then your results shock them than to make so much noise. I can cook for 1,000 people. Just give me this money. I know what I'm saying. Is it cooking? What is there in cooking? Then the food is smelling smoke all around. Burnt the meat, burnt the food, burnt everything. Packaging is good. but have content. Have content. Build your mind. Buy the truth. Buy books. Buy materials. I can spend the whole night teaching on the mind. Focus on changing your mind, brothers and sisters, and I promise you, your life will change. Don't get into this pressure of living a fake life. If all you have today is Gary, take it with honor. Use your 2,000 naira, buy a Bible, buy a book, read, pay for seminars. You are buying the truth. You are investing your destiny. Yes, I know you have one trouser. The trouser is torn around. Sew it with honor. Let them laugh at you. A day will come, you will own a clothing line. All these things, somebody just finished, is a graduate. You are moving around. When you are going somewhere, you go and change 10,000 naira. You have 20,000 savings. You change 20,000 to 500 naira new note. And you just go and dash over and say, well, it's part of what God has done now. You take, look at the fake life. Social media has helped us to live very fake lives. Now there are positive aspects of it. People snap near cars that are not their own. They stand near a plane and snap. They do all kinds. So you don't even know. It's better for you to know where you are so that you can rise. There is a way you live a life that is too fake. You don't even know that it's fake again. Are we together? You go to a house that is not near your house. Stand in front of the gate, just put one leg and snap, and then you go around. Now let me tell you what, every time you create expectations that are higher than your capacity, what you do is that you cause men to expect more from you. Are we together?
Yes.
Packaging without mental upgrade will always lead to frustration. There are many pastors. I love them. I love the body of Christ. But you see a lot of people. This guy will wear suit. You think if you match the ground, every wheelchair will stand up. Wear the suit. Wear tie. Wear all kinds of things. Pocket square. All kinds of things. Bible. iPad. Another book. One protocol. One for whoever it is that is standing by the side. And you hold the mic. One scripture you can quote. One prayer you can pray. Man of God, I don't know what to do about my finances. As well, God will attend to your needs. Look at the answer he's giving. No knowledge of the principles of the kingdom. Yet you are the first to spend all your money. So you go to a meeting like this, you come for Koinonia, stand outside and snap and use it to publicize your church. You say, come, there is an overflowing abundance of people. There are four members in your church. It's not a thing to laugh at. God is going to lift you. You see, people live all kinds of fake lives. You don't know what is true and what is not true. You are selling wrappers. It's all right. But you go somewhere to one big boutique and snap yourself and say, me in one of my shops. You are lying. It is the truth that sets free, brothers and sisters. Not everybody dances to a fake life. There are people who can see you and say, I know you are starting, but I'm taking the risk to lift you and support you. Are we together?
Yes.
Say, I receive grace to work on my mind first. Ladies, some of you spend all kinds of hilarious amount on hair, on rings, on clothes, on hands. You are creating an impression. Are you working? No. Well, how much is your salary per month? It just comes as a favor, opens up doors for me anyhow. So why are you living like that? A restaurant that everybody there is a CEO, you too, you enter there. Number one, you have not grown to that level, so you don't even know that they don't call people. With every lifting, life teaches you the protocol of that realm. When you force yourself into that realm, you don't know the protocol of that realm. If you have truly gotten to that level, let me tell you, the justice system of God is such that you will learn. The day you can get to a restaurant where it's a buffet, you will already know the precepts of that level. Be careful. Let me speak to some of us here who are leaders, business leaders, ministry people. Be careful as you attempt to lift people. Don't be so sympathetic about people that you lift them beyond their current level of dealing with God in a bid to help them, you will expose them to dimensions they are not prepared for, and it will destroy them. Sometimes you see people crying. Somebody just comes to you and says, I have a crusade. Money is not coming. Say, really? Oh yeah, bring your account. 2 million. God is trying to teach him how to trust. You destroy that lecture. You gave the guy 2 million. Do you know what he's going to say? He was begging you, crying, but he will arrogantly stand before his members and say, if you have ever doubted that there's oil on my head, go and check my bank account. Now, that guy has not learned anything. Most people will use your help to prove that they had faith. They didn't know you helped them. Me, I don't pray. Things just happen in my life. I'm like that. I mean, all this, I don't waste my time praying. Because you have been reaping somebody's seed. The day your farm will be open, you will see that, what they call that thing, shifting cultivation, that you have to allow a farm for it, because you have allowed it, bush fallow, what they call all those agri terminologies. You have to sit down for years tilling the ground you left for a long time. Corporate success is good for the organization, but dangerous for individuals. Because you won't know who is really producing the result. See, let me encourage you, everyone, especially the workers in this ministry. We share our success. Now, I've taught in this ministry the principles of shared dominion. If somebody says today, Apostle, you are very anointed, we share it. I'm not anointed alone. There were people who made that possible. However, be careful lest you hide in the midst of crowd to say, we are moving forward. Are you moving forward? That's the danger with things like group work. 10 people can do an assignment. Only 2 are serious. The remaining 2 will sleep. All of them will get 9/10. And the other person will come and say, Kai, God is faithful. You are not smart. You are not learning. In the office, they give assignments. And they come and give everybody bonuses. And you are rejoicing, yet you are not growing. Enjoy corporate success. But vet yourself to make sure you are an active contributor. That your input is in that equation of success. How is the mind renewed? Quickly. This is what we can take. We'll just stop here. How is the mind renewed? We need to learn how to transform the mind. Number one, a recognition. Transformation starts with a recognition that your old ideas cannot take you to your destiny. Transformation of the mind starts with a recognition that your old ideas, the ideas that are currently resident within your mind, are not sufficient to take you to the place of destiny. That's the first key. A recognition that something I know now is limiting me, or something I do not know is limiting me. That's the first step. Whoever can recognize that is my place of destiny, but as it is, where I am now cannot take me there. Leads us to point number 2. The second key to the renewal of the mind is access to new ideas, access to revelation, access to useful information. You can't think the way you are thinking now and rise. As a pastor, as a businessman, as a career person, as a student, as a family man, as a wife, as a mother, as a child, no. Your thought process thus far is what brought you where you are. So you have to think. I look at my life today and I look at it maybe 5, 6, 7, 8 years. I look at the things I knew and I'm surprised that I could even rise with that level of knowledge. Because compared to what I know now, I was in total ignorance. I probably would have argued then. But truly speaking, I would say I was in total ignorance. Understanding the systems of God now, I'm in shock. That's why I glorify God, because I see His mercy all the way. There is something you can know that will take your church to the next level. There is something Koinonia can know now that can open us to a new season. See, leaders, learn this. You are a pastor, businessman, leader, whatever you are, listen to me. Your ministry or organization will rise and stop at the level of thinking of the leader. Are we together? It is a very sincere statement. You are a CEO of a group. That group will only rise to match your level of understanding and stop there, because you are the chief legislator of that organization. If I stop growing as a person, spiritually, intellectually, otherwise, Koinonia will rise to the level of my understanding and stop there. We will only be recycling knowledge. So whilst God is granting me grace to feed you with truth, I myself am a student of higher mantles, greater graces, uncommon leadership, and I mean it, uncommon leadership. You know, sometimes when I sit down and read these books or watch these people, I sit down and I try to say, my God, what constructed their understanding to be this flawless? Access to new ideas. Number three, repetition of the ideas in your mind until conviction is established. The third way to renew your mind is not just to have access to ideas, but those ideas must be repeated until conviction is established. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing. That you heard it once does not mean you have built conviction. There are messages I've listened to more than 1,500 times. One message. God is my witness and I lie not. The goal is not just to hear. I have understood the principle. I wish we had time. I would have taught you how the mind works. Right? Generally speaking, there are two dimensions to the mind. There is what we call the conscious mind and what we call the subconscious mind. The conscious part of the mind is the area that connects with your senses, your physical senses. That's where you do your thinking. That's where you do your reasoning. That's where you do your analysis. Unfortunately, that's not where your behavior comes from. That's not where your convictions come from. That's where your intention comes from. The conscious part of your mind. Then there is the subconscious part of your mind. That's the seat of conviction. Whatever enters your subconscious mind must manifest in your life. So the Bible says in Genesis chapter 11, right? When you read from verse 5 and 6, the Bible says God came down. Nimrod, the son of Cush, gathered a people and said, go to come. Let us build a city whose top will reach the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves. And then the Bible says that God said in verse 5, can you give it to us please? Genesis 11 and verse 5. Genesis 11 and verse 5. The Bible says that God said he came down to see, and the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. Hold on. They had not started building. They were mobilizing themselves. But the Bible says God came down to see the city that has already been built. Once you build it in your mind, you build it in your life. So says God himself. Verse 6. And the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they all have one language, and this they begin to do. Listen. And now nothing. Everybody say nothing. Who is talking here? God. Nothing will be restrained from them. Not which they intended, which they imagined to do. It first happens in your mind. I saw these days years ago. The mental level I am now, the physical reality is not yet the reflection. Tomorrow will tell you my thought process. What we are enjoying today was yesterday's thinking. Are you hearing what I'm saying now? Your family is a reflection of the thinking of your father and mother. It's a reflection of their ideas. Your life now is a reflection of your ideas. Listen, the subconscious mind, there's something very powerful about it. The subconscious mind does not know the difference between reality and imagination. Wow. It cannot distinguish between what is imagined and what is real. In the world of your subconscious mind, whether you are looking at this or imagining it, it interprets it as real. That's why the Bible says, now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly far above all we ask, or because your imagination is a request. Your imagination is a request. You are crying out to your destiny to come. So the Bible says, Philippians chapter 4, please. Give us verse 8. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Thank you, Jesus. Finally, brethren, in light of the fact that your destiny is a sum total of your thought pattern, he said, whatsoever things are what? True. Whatsoever things are honest. Whatsoever things are just. Whatsoever things are pure. Whatsoever things are lovely. Whatsoever things are of good report. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise. What's the assignment? Don't just pray. Think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. Brothers and sisters, I think on many things. When I look at you, I think of how you will be, not how you are now. No. That's why there's nobody I look at and conclude over. No. No matter how you are. When I look at you, my eyes are seeing your today, but my spirit, my mind has captured your tomorrow. I look at my life today and I'm already seeing when the nations will come and worship. Our hearts, our prayer is to see the nations worship. Our desire and our prayer is to sing your praise from the ends of the earth, that we'd one mighty voice, every tribe and tongue rejoices, our hearts and our desires to see the nations worship. No leader enters a future he cannot see. Son of man, what seest thou? Businessman, what seest thou? My brother, my sister, tonight, what do you see? I see pain in my family. I see divorce. I see the fact that I've been delayed. Be careful. You are programming your mind to reproduce that. Hallelujah. Are we together? Pray in 1 minute. Pray in 1 minute and say, Lord, change my vision. I have allowed life to give me wrong perceptions and I'm programming my life wrongly. Pray, pray. Shalabrakosia. We'll soon stop, but I want you to get this, Lord. It's important what you see, your perception. He looked at a weak man, Gideon, and he said, I see a mighty man of valor. Brothers and sisters, since I was nothing and I didn't have anything, I saw a great destiny. That's what I see. I know what I see. In the glory and the power, I see miracles. That's my life. I'm a sign and wonder. It's in the glory and the power. I see miracles, signs and wonders. Years ago, I would go to our boys' quarters in the night alone. I never knew my mother was watching me. I would get a stick, and I was seeing these days. I was preaching. I would stand, I would just go imaginary in the air, and say, in the name of Jesus, rise up from the wheelchair. That's what I was doing. And I will feel the anointing. Because you see, the Holy Spirit works through your mind. I told you, your mind doesn't care whether it's imagination or not. Job said, the thing I feared most came upon me. I thought about it, accident, until a car killed me. All I see is a great destiny. That's what I see for myself. All I see is koinonia rising from glory to glory. I never see bomb blast. I never see trouble. I see myself as a leader over men of influence. I have never seen impossibility in my life. And I'm not joking. I said this when I could not buy a shoe. It's seeing the glory and the power. I see miracles, signs and wonders. I'm in the glory and the power. I'm a living miracle and a sign and wonder. Listen, you must stop looking down on yourself. Many of you said, why do the heathens rage and the people imagine a vain thing? That's why they execute it. You imagine a vain thing. You imagine failure. I am nothing. I graduated with third class. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? I can't speak well. I am too old. Oh, come on now. Oh, come on now. We're talking about the God of heaven. The one who can change people. Listen. Listen. Someone asked me one day and said, Apostle, God has blessed you so much with gifted people. How do you get them? And I told him, I see them. I see a service conducted by music ministers who as individuals are international figures. You have been allowing the devil plant nonsense in your mind. There are ladies here. Whereas there is Esther in you, Vashti is calling you. Your destiny is calling you, but your yesterday is pulling you back. Remember, you failed. You failed jam 5 times. What is the definition of a failure? Then you submit to it. The moment you submit to it, you destroy yourself. Listen, every great man is a man who changed his mind. Literally, right from the time I was having bread, I will cut the bread and put granite in the middle. I knew that a day will come, I will feed nations. Ask Ejimi. We had a song.
Ask and I'll give the nations to you, oh Lord.
That was our song.
That's the cry of my heart. Distant shores and the islands will sing your light as it rises on earth. Yeah. Ask and I'll give the nations to you, oh Lord. That's the cry of my heart. Distant shores and the islands will sing your light.
Before God gave me access to the heart of kings, I saw myself. I knew that there was an anointing. Every apostle was connected to kings. I found it from scripture. And I said, no, there is a mantle upon my life. There are people here. From our first crusades, we will go and greet kings. Go and greet the kings in the land. It was a seed. Listen, tomorrow will never appear till you call it. You will call it. Your mind is a fruitful part of your destiny. The Holy Spirit is crippled. If your mind says yes, no demon can say no. Believe me. Hallelujah. Listen. The Lord gave me a very great testimony. I think it was day before yesterday or yesterday. Something happened. And It's something I had seen in my spirit, I had seen in my mind. And I would not see it physically. And then the Lord gave me a very big miracle. When it manifested and I looked at it, it was exactly what I had seen in the spirit. And I said, this God, believe him. Did you hear what I said? I'm going to teach you the law of faith. I thought we would have more time. There are many laws to teach you. Brothers and sisters, when you activate these things, by next week when we are done, I'm going to spend the night before next week praying all the oils that will be used. I will lie down and pray on it. When we are done, that oil, as it comes on your head, you will activate systems. Listen, my brother, my sister, it will shock you. This life you see is a living miracle. It's a product of understanding. This is what dominion is. It's not guesswork. I saw myself walking in the anointing. I saw it. I saw shadows healing the sick. I saw it. It's not some vain nonsense imagination. I believe it. The only audience in my vision, yet I pulled it down, and it will cause nations to see it. You are the first to live in your future. And then I speak it. Lord, it will happen. I will stand before kings. They will come, Gentiles. I saw a ministry that was zero debt, owing no man nothing as a ministry, dead or alive. I saw it. Where did the money come from? Your mind. There is nobody giving any guarantee anywhere. There are people frowning. My uncle didn't give me 10 naira. Nobody's uncle promises him anything. Leave all those dependence, careless dependence. Everything comes from above. It comes through men, not from men. From God, through men to you. Men are not your source, they are channels. It comes from God. We are going to pray. Is someone angry? Are you seeing how you have authorized? I've only taught you four laws. Some of you have missed it in relationships. Some of you have missed it. Your gift is not speaking. Some of you, mediocrity. Just these four laws alone are enough to open your destiny. See, God instructed me to teach you this series because God wants to roll away shame. Shame. He has taken all the pain. You've taken all the lamentation. You've taken all disappointment. You've taken all my sorrow. You have taken all my sadness. You've taken all limitations. You've taken all the pain. You've taken all the shame. You have made them yours.
The highest praise to the King.
What some of your family members would have been had they known these laws. They destroyed relationships and it has grounded them. Some of them, the last time they worked was 1997. No door opened till today. Sincere, well-meaning believers, but they have not understood the systems of the kingdom. Nobody is born with understanding. You buy the truth. I want you to lift your voice and prophesy. I found my way. I found my way. I found my way. I found my way out of misery. Hey.
point number one. Lord, I begin to live my life from the standpoint of these laws. I engage them. I receive grace. Lift your voice and pray. Grace. Grace to engage these laws. Grace to engage these laws. Yes, Lord, you are taking me from glory to glory. Are you not the Lord of all flesh? You are not a man that you should lie, not the son of man that you should lie. Hallelujah. You know that song, right? That Nathaniel Bassi song. Just sing it once. I want us to sing it. Let the devil know that we're serious.
You're always turning things around. Our love won't come, but you're always turning things around. Our love won't come, but you're always turning things around. Our love won't come, but you're always turning things around.
But let's just pray for 2 minutes. I want you to forget where you are now. Forget what you cannot eat now. I want you to see a bright future. Draw from that future and start prophesying. I'm coming to you. I'm coming to you. I'm coming to you. Shepa kato soto elekaya. No devil stops me. In the name of Jesus, that realm of the anointing. I'm coming to you. That realm of I want to add one last prayer. Our time is gone. Listen, we are going to pray. There is a spirit that can destroy all these things you have had. It's called the spirit of fear. Apostle, will it work? Are you joking? The laws that founded the universe, these are not scientific laws. They were not invented. No, the very laws. Listen, God told Job in chapter 38 verse 33, he says, knowest thou the ordinances of heaven, and canst thou establish their dominion upon the earth? We are not talking about what we are guessing. These are not cunningly devised fables. These are the secrets, age-long secrets.
I like you right now to challenge the spirit of fear. Call it by name and drive it from your life. I open the door and I ask you out of my life. Out of my life. God has not given me the spirit of fear. That goal is achievable. That dimension of anointing is accessible. That dimension of ministry. That dimension of business. It is doable. I believe. I agree with heaven. I agree with my dreams. I agree with my vision. Nothing stops me. I come in the name of the Lord. Assisted by the spirit of wisdom. Assisted by the power of the Holy Ghost. I challenge mediocrity. I aim high. I aim for the stars. In the name of Jesus, I refuse to be small. I contend for kingdom influence. I contend for kingdom success. I break the laws of the spirit. And with them I purchase treasures. Treasures that are not affordable to men. Please lift your hands. Let me pray for you. In the name of Jesus, I cast away the spirit of fear now. I cast it now. I'm seeing it. That's why I'm praying. I cast away the spirit of fear now. I curse you by the God of heaven. I cast away the spirit of fear now. I decree and declare. Impartation of confidence, may it come upon you now. The Bible says to cast not away your confidence, for it has a great recompense of reward. I decree and declare that everything that attempts to make you feel you will end up like those that you have seen fall, I challenge that voice now. I challenge that voice now. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I release fresh dreams. I release fresh visions. Fresh expectations. Where you have watered down God's expectation because of fear, I lift it back to God's standard. In the name of Jesus Christ. And I decree and declare that as you apply, we have done four. There are many more. But these four, I release grace upon them. And I anoint these laws to work for you. I anoint these laws to work for you. They will work like magic for you. In the name of Jesus. Beginning from tonight, not tomorrow, begin to command testimonies from these laws. Open doors from these laws. Restorations from these laws. Breakthroughs from these laws. Anybody that will make you doubt this loss, may God take them far from you. There is somebody here. Next week Friday is with tears you will stand and testify here. I'm speaking to you by the Spirit. This is not for everybody, but there is somebody. What will happen from tomorrow till next week Friday, I say it by the Spirit of God, is with your tears you will stand here testifying. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, don't ever call anything impossible. You are not dealing with an intelligent man. You are dealing with God. If you don't fear man, fear God. Are we together? To ask whether the laws will work is to mock God. It is sin. It is sin. It's not only bad, it is sin. You hear what I'm saying? There is no amount of money you need that you will be getting it for the first time. There is no amount of breakthrough you are looking for. No, not for your small shop. To doubt God. not for your CGPA, not for your graduation. Take away the fears and focus and say, Lord, I trust you. Let God be true and all men liars. He said, God is not a man that he should lie, not the son of man that he should repent. I say it again, every hanging prophecy that is over your life, that the devil is trying to make it look like it will not come to pass, I release an anointing now. I command that it comes to pass now. Let it come to pass. I release the grace for performance. The grace for performance. The grace for performance. I command it to come to pass. The grace for performance. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we give you praise for tonight. We honor you because you are building us. We will experience strange dimensions of triumph in the name of Jesus. You're standing here tonight and you're saying, man of God, I do not have a relationship with Jesus. I will not tell lies. I see the move of the Spirit in this place and I need Jesus. Please keep standing, everyone. Our time is gone. We're rounding up. I need Jesus. Or you're saying, man of God, as I heard you speak, I knew that I was lacking in my relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I have come here tonight with my heart open. I've been lying to myself, but tonight I'm ready to tell the truth. Overflow one, overflow two, overflow three, online, inside, wherever you are, our time is gone. I want to count one to three. Run like there's fire on the mountain. Don't wait for anyone. Make your way out quickly. Make your way out quickly. Are there people coming? Clear the way for them. Somebody has got to be convicted of the Spirit. Young, old, make your way quickly. There are people coming outside. Please clear the way for them. Ushers, help them. Overflow one, two, three. If you are coming, run, 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 run. Young and old, run quickly, please. Keep coming. God bless you. Our time is gone, but we must give you an opportunity for a fresh start tonight. Man of God, I want to rededicate my life. I'm tired of living my life my own way. Make your way to the front. No matter the limitations, God is giving you a new beginning. Are you coming? Don't let your friends stop you. Run, join them quickly. Hallelujah. If you're joining them quickly, just join them and then we'll pray. Those in front, I honor you. Thank you so much. Lift your right hand and say this after me. Convincingly, truthfully, you're not reciting a poem. Say, Lord Jesus, I love you. I believe in you. Tonight, I hand over my life to you. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. I receive eternal life into my spirit. I declare that I'm a child of God from now and forever. Keep your hands lifted. Father, receive these ones. I pray that this will begin. You start the beginning of a new life. I command every spirit that is not of God to leave you. And I decree and declare that beginning from today, the life of God finds expression in you. I curse everything that does not belong to Christ. I release you to serve the Lord. I declare that your sins are forgiven and the Lord gives you a new beginning. In Jesus' name I pray. Thank you so much and congratulations. Please follow the gentleman waving his hands. All of you just follow him. They'll have your details very, very quickly. Hallelujah. Just two announcements for tonight. The first announcement, aside from Honorable and his wife, if this is your first time worshiping with us here at Koinonia Overflow 1, 2, 3, I know there are a number of people. Please, you will need to run. Aside from those coming out, wherever you are, come. I want to bless you. I want to speak over your life. Koinonia, honor them. Those connecting with us for the first time online, we love you. We bless you. Are you coming? Quickly, please.
Hello, beloved in Christ. We hope this message was a blessing to you. I would want you to do something for us. If you are new here, kindly hit on that subscribe button for us. And then like this video as well. Share to your family and friends to bless them. Because we know that this message will be a blessing to their body, to their soul, and to their spirit. We would need you to do one thing for us too. Tell us in the comment section where you were watching us from. And then if you've got any testimony for us, kindly share with us. Thank you for watching.
In the name of Jesus, drought in your life, that even when it is physical rainy season, it is still dry season spiritually, financially, and otherwise, I decree and declare, let the rain begin to fall. Let the rain begin to fall. Let the rain